It's version 1.5.0.
So, first night shift. It shouldn't be too hard.
This sounds like auto-generated text speech, which I don't mind. It's better than not having it at all. Hold on, I'm like way down here. I should be a little higher up. There we go. And then when I fix that rectangle on my arm, everything's gonna be fine.
I can't end my shift and go to sleep until I complete my tasks for today. Should be written in a car somewhere.
So this is, first of all, hi Hotbot, hello.
They have only one tune for all their facilities. Good one, though.
Okay, so they have successfully lampshaded how they have one song that I figured would be prominent. Because when you have, like, a $5 indie game, and it has some...
Broken, but it's woke me up to my shift.
Nice, comfy, like, intro music. It's like, okay, we're gonna be listening to this, like, all the time, right? It's like,
It still feels awesome to have water all day without schedule. It's better to save it, though.
My model!
This bathroom is about the size of my apartments in Bright City, and I would be locked there for months now. I'd better keep this job.
There's so much fun stuff in here.
The place seemed creepy when I arrived, so I locked the door. The keys should be around somewhere.
So we have a job in this game, and it's not a very spooky job. Well, I mean, it's like a...
This bathroom is about the size of my apartments in Bright City.
Oh, don't keep talking.
For months now. I'd better keep this
you can turn them off. There's a control option for that, which means they probably got the feedback at some point. They're like, man, she talks too much. Whoa! Look at that nice Sumashi split system air conditioning unit. Common in such small spaces because it's ductless.
This bathroom is about the size of my apartments in Bright City, and I would be locked there for months now.
I might need to have her shut up, but I need to find the keys.
The place seemed creepy when I arrived, so I locked the door. The keys should be around. Crappy memory, but at least I'm well organized.
There are no keys in here. Did I take them quickly on accident? Because I was mashing? I don't care. I'm out of here. Oh, fuck. Sometimes you gotta remember to treat it like an indie game. Can I lock it? No, I can't. Okay. We're in G Rand Rock.
Walk around while everyone's on lockdown is cheering me up. They don't want me to walk out of the motel without a car. They didn't say why. Spooky.
I'll simply take this one. This looks like a good car.
Hey Jasper, what's with the moody atmosphere? Great talk as always. Thanks for keeping the keys safe, Jasper.
It's just this guy. The G Rand Rock. Hello, Eldergoth. We're on the search for. Oh, stuff.
I'd say Jasper's creepy if I haven't seen the day shift's workers.
There's some fucking noises happening. Look at this car. It has a big fucking light glued to the top.
With the spotlight switched off, this makes no sense.
She's saying a lot of things. Oh! What just happened? Why is my car like this? How did I push that? I missed it. I don't know how I did that. Jump button.
I have nothing to store here yet. Smell of old leather, gas, and alcohol. Yep, I love this car.
What?
I'll call you Christine from now on. I don't know you, Clark, but I'm grateful. Music can save my day. Or night, actually. Also, I hope you... A note to remember. It's not a video game. Arrow points to the north and not towards my target.
What do I look at? Oh. Clark, I was driving this car. Cool job. It gets lonely. I made a mixtape. They lampshaded the music, too. Look, I appreciate it. This is not an expensive game, but it's very cute. No bitch-assness here. We're here for vibes. That's a vibe. Where's...
Well, so this car can't work normally with the spotlight on. Good to know. No multitasking for Christine.
How do I... Okay, how do I get out? There we go. That's for later. How do I turn it off?
I have nothing to store here yet.
What's the button for the spotlight in here? Aha. Oh, wonderful. Oh, all my doors and my trunk are open.
I wonder if they planted this tree or built a motel around it.
What tree? I can't see the tree.
They don't want me to walk out of the motel.
Oh, this tree.
Car. They didn't say why. Spooky.
A good question. I could see it either going either way. I hate this logo. Why is the R big? Why is it the G Rand Rock? Look, I'm gonna close this all this shit. Maybe I'll get into character for the first time in my whole fucking life playing a video game. I'll stop goofing off. Handbrake. Lost Wyvern. Oh. Yeah, so... I believe what we're trying to do is, like, chase a giant... thing out of town. Silent Peak Lighthouse. Nice and subtle name there. Windland Plains. Like, bright blue light. How do we get there? There we go. I'm not as into, like, the first person. This feels more immersive, ironically. Well, I guess they're both okay, but... Damn it.
This is Archie Blue bringing you another in our series of stories of the unusual. And once again, we caution you, these lights-out stories are definitely not for the timid soul. So we tell you calmly and very sincerely, if you frighten easily, turn off your radio now.
Alpha, there's clearly, like, no one in here.
If I call Jasper from a phone booth, this will become evacuation point instead of ground rock. If I stuck somewhere... Or when I stuck.
What do you think? Should we go to where it was last seen or where it lives? We'll go to where it was last seen.
Oh, thank you.
Just some proper detective shit.
How's the family waiting? How am I in trouble? The last lights out, I just don't know what to write about.
Windland Plains, they produce most of the energy for Woodville and Bright City. But I remember frequent shutdowns this time of the year. I wonder, was it because of Titans?
Yeah, okay. Sure, I'll make this last one a good one, and then that'll be that. If I live through it. Huh? No, I was just talking to myself. I've been doing that rather consistently these last few days.
Yeah, I'm a professional.
All those zombies and ghouls and Luke Carews have finally caught up with me. Yeah, I know. Two aspirins and a glass of water every half hour. Now look here, Miss Harrison, don't worry.
Two aspirins every half hour.
It's a story written tonight if I have to talk to the devil himself to do it. Alright, sure. Oh, fine. Call me back in an hour and I'll have some kind of a plot figured out. I hope. In my regards to Norman. Talk to you later.
If this gets redundant, I'm gonna find some Art Bell podcasts and put those on.
What time is it anyway?
11:32.
Sorry I have to keep you working so late.
That's perfectly all right. I know you have to have that pay done by tomorrow morning. I'm glad to help.
You're an angel. Angel.
The handbrake is a toggle.
That's a strange word to use here in this room where I've thought up so many demons and monsters. Tell me, or maybe you won't want to tell me.
What, Miss Elbert?
Working with me on these lighthouse plays, do you ever get frightened?
Well...
You do, don't you?
Yes, I do get frightened many times.
There was a time I'd have
thought I heard something.
Amusing, but not tonight.
There's so many windmills.
I don't know. Tell me, did you ever sit alone in a room at night and have a premonition? I mean, suddenly get the feeling that somewhere in the...
Oh, I just put a cinder block on the gas. Something was waiting, something I don't need the brakes. There's a handbrake knob.
If I keep on talking like this, they'll be using me as Exhibit X in the psychopathic ward.
I will simply hit the e-brake if I need to slow down.
We'll start out next week.
Wow.
Oh,
she's beautiful. I hope she's not hungry.
Oh, there's a friend.
First character's name, Hellman. Call Hellman. Jack Hellman. H-E-L-M-N.
Mm-hmm. You gotta say hi.
Murder and he,
Oh! Oh, hello. Oh, no, she's... Well. Goodbye.
She probably flew to another bridge. At least it's the right direction to the Silent Peak.
That wasn't even music. Here, can I, Let's see here. Get some Art Bell going. Weird sounds. September 1, 1994, September 2nd. Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell.
From the high desert and the great American Southwest, I bid you all good evening or good morning. And welcome to another edition, a Friday night, Saturday morning edition of Coast to Coast AM. Live talk radio throughout the nighttime. Now the largest, fastest growing all-night program in America, period. It's good to be with you. I promised you John Lear this morning, and so it shall be. Put a little tweak in there, didn't I?
What?
All right, John Lear. It's been a long time since John has been on the program. John doesn't really do interviews to speak of. A lot of you don't know who John Lear is, so John Lear is an airline captain. He is that now. He's flown 160 different types of aircraft in over 50 different countries in all types of flying. Experimental test flying, production test flying, airline passenger flying, cargo hauling, movie work, stunt flying, aircraft ferrying, air dropping missions, air racing, and government secret missions of all kinds. Lear has held 18 world speed records in the Learjet, including speed around the world, and holds the most FAA airman certificates issued to a single individual, which include the airline transport rating, flight instructor, ground instructor, navigator, flight engineer, flight dispatcher, airframe and power plant mechanic, control tower operator, and parachute rigger. He has been a commercial pilot for 34 years, has been flying for 38 years. He holds the Professional Air Traffic Controllers Award for Outstanding Airmanship, presented in 1968. He has flown missions worldwide for various government agencies. He flew in Cambodia, Vietnam, and Laos between 1960.
They're giving all this intro, and then he's going to come on and be like, I saw a UFO.
Middle East, Afghanistan, the Far East, and Africa. As a non-sked pilot, he has over 17,000 hours of flight time.
Airplane.
Of which over 13,000 hours are in jets. Lear's father was William P. Lear, Sr., who not only helped develop the first car radio, the 8-track stereo, and the automatic pilot for fighter aircraft, but who also developed, of course, the Lear jet, one of the first and most successful of all business jet aircraft. Lear studied the industrial design at the Art Center College in Los Angeles, and was a state senate candidate in Nevada in 1980. He has written extensively about airplanes and other subjects, was Middle East correspondent for Combat Illustrated between 1975 and 77.
One of those games where I can't resist skyrimming.
He is an amateur photographer and
a mountain goat.
Has won several photography awards for pictures taken during his worldwide travels. In the early 70s, John Lear owned and skipped...
Oh, I might not be able to jump this high.
America's Cup boat Soliloquy out of Marina Del Rey. His interest in UFOs began after reading Bud Hopkins' book, Missing Time. Then, a chance encounter with a U.S. Air Force pilot, who was at a base in...
Fuck it, fuck it.
...terrestrial craft landed in December.
My knees are fine.
In 1988, John met a government scientist who worked on a back engineering program of recovered extraterrestrial flying saucers for the Department of Naval Intelligence at a secret base within the Nevada test site known only as S-4. This scientist not only explained how these craft traveled many times faster than the speed of light, but in March of 1989, took John to a remote desert location to watch the Navy test fly one of those extraterrestrial craft.
My spotlight is pointless here.
Ah, boo.
John, who no longer gives lectures...
Oh, it's got, like, light trail. Ooh.
...subject of UFOs, and has no plans, incidentally, to write a book, is currently a DC-8 captain with a major cargo carrier, has four daughters, and lives in Las Vegas with...
Now I get blue light.
...Marilee. So that's a pretty full plate for anybody's life, I would say, and a little fuller than mine has been, certainly, and I think most. In just one moment, we'll get to John Lear, and I think you'll find him more than just a little fascinating.
Jasper, I'm stuck. I need a vacation.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, here comes John Lear. John, well, wait a minute. Let me put you on hold there and bring you up here. John, it's been a long time since we've had you on the program. Welcome back.
Well, thank you.
Oh, okay. That's how you get back to the motel if you get stuck.
At least that long.
That's helpful.
John. And the network in that time has grown magnificently. I think we've gone from about 28 stations to about 120.
Yeah, we found the titter. I don't know what to do about it, though.
We've come a long way, baby. Well, anyway, John, you've done a lot in your life, haven't you?
I got blue light.
Yeah, a little bit here and there.
It's been awfully busy. I mean, this is quite a resume you've got, and that's a lot to do in a life.
I steal this.
And then all of a sudden, at some point, you decided to mix into all of this, which is enough for about two people normally, and you got involved in UFOs.
Yes, involuntarily, I might add.
Involuntarily. Well, look, we'll get to that. You've done something kind of interesting. You've given me this timeline, and I do appreciate it. I would like to go back over the history a little bit. With you, John, and pick your brain about what you know about the incidents that you have listed for me. Did modern UFO ufology really begin about 1947?
Yeah, it really did with the
what?
Ken Arnold
sighting.
But now there's been a lot that happened before that. There was
look toes.
a recovery, I think, in 1941, I think in Arizona, and there was a lot of activity during World War II, but really modern ufology started in 1947 with the recovery, well,
ufology.
General fighting up in Seattle, I think it was, and then the recovery of the craft in Roswell, New Mexico.
Well, I'm not familiar with the Arnold sighting.
Well, the Ken Arnold sighting was when he saw those nine discs.
Where's... Okay, Bill's Silent Peak.
And, he saw
I think
discs, and when he landed,
that looks like the Silent Hill font, or very close.
He said, well, they look kind of like saucers, and that was the, was the first coining of the term flying saucers.
Ah.
And this happened, like, in late June.
Oh, yeah, it's still, like, right there.
And coincidentally, just, you know, like a week later was this recovery of the craft in Roswell.
Oh, that's
well,
okay.
I
see.
Modern ufology, really, there have been sightings, I suppose, for as long as man has been around to record them, haven't there?
Yeah, at least.
I turn on the handbrake. Oh, nice. If you leave, it automatically brakes. it's not helping.
Okay. Now to Roswell, very quickly. I interviewed. The author of the book, The Truth About the UFO Crash at Roswell.
I remember hiking around this.
And he did a pretty good job of documenting what I guess is. Would you say it is the best documentation of something that has happened?
He
was supposed to walk the stairs, Titans.
Well, no, that's right.
The view from up here is quite nice.
It is. And I know you looked at Roswell. I guess it's probably one of the first things that you studied when you jumped into all this. What kind
of
conclusions did you draw about it, John?
Well, at that time, 1985, when I first got in there, I think it was then there was over 200
people
that were still alive that they had either touched or loaded or seen.
Oh, here we go.
Trapped in the body. A good portion of those people are still alive now, but it was overwhelming evidence that this occurred.
What actually supposedly happened? Was what is the best guess? Was there a collision? Did it blow up? Does anybody speculate about what happened to this craft?
There's theories, and I don't think it's so much so important as what happened.
Oh, we have to do a power thing.
Yeah.
Some people say there was two craft.
There's a lot going on here.
They never came this close. They were pretty close.
Big switch.
And the wyvern in the short side. I need to lead only the closest one to her, one at a time.
Whatever did happen, they certainly collected a large amount of debris, and there was a lot of people involved in the effort. But what was so
she still
is the preparedness of the military to deal with this. There was no
they left.
They knew exactly what to do. They knew exactly what they had, and that among and they were very well prepared.
What's
that noise?
So that would indicate to you, I guess, that they had some knowledge of what was going on or some interaction.
Oh, so it likes blue light?
That there was a probability of
this is going to be great.
Could happen, and they were very well prepared.
All right, also in that same timeline, 1947, the establishment, the original establishment of MJ-12. And the MJ-12 documents, which I've seen, John, do you view those as legitimate?
The information is legitimate, not necessarily the documents. President Truman certainly informed MJ-12 on September 24th, 1947. There's enough evidence in government documents that he did have a meeting with certain people and did inform his body that he has been charged.
What was the job of MJ-12? It had a charter, right? What was it supposed to do?
It switches on the other side.
God
damn it. Who designed that?
Research the craft to determine what it was made of, whether there was a threat to this country, and to determine what should be done to help at all.
It just respawns you if you go too deep. Oh, there's a bridge.
So they kind of were the overseers of all this.
Yeah, they were.
Here, let me see if I can find a
the original 12 that were appointed.
Like a Chupacabra episode or something.
That died, I think it was 1983, and then the Secretary of the Army, Gordon Gray. He was the last number. As to who is involved or a member of MJ-12 today, we can only speculate. I really don't know, but...
Well, since that time, there must have been many members. In other words, people die, people retire, people get sick, all kinds of things. So if it's... Are you saying it's still in place today?
Yes, MJ-12 certainly is in place. And they have, they would have had...
That might be hard to find.
The original 12, I don't think it would be more than 30 were probably ever involved.
Oh, they have a little bit.
People talk
of...
on about this current administration, the Clinton administration.
And, oh, here we go.
How open they've been.
We're going to switch from the UFO topic to the paranormal. SH Mumbler, welcome. Or Shumumbler. Mumbler. I always filled out the SH meaning Silent Hill in my head. Like, it's Silent Hill Mumbler, because it's Mumbler from Silent Hill.
First, of course, the world's expert, well-acknowledged world's expert on...
Oh, it's very comfy. I'm into it.
...animal mutilations and an extending field. That's Linda Howe. She'll be...
I've switched off the in-game radio stuff. We're listening to some Art Bell.
...who has written over 100 books, the latest of which is called The Awful Thing in the Attic. I thought they were generally in the cellar. But this one definitely is in the attic. We'll find out. Brad Steiger, a well-known Brad Steiger, is going to be my guest.
And so hanging out.
Kind of a little bit of an idea of what's coming up.
I'm very into the idea of these games that are kind of like moody and dark and have the spooky atmosphere, but they're not like... They're simultaneously not combat-oriented. Like, we're not trying to kill this thing. And also, it's not just like a super boring walking simulator. Like, we get to drive around and stuff. That's fun.
California, myself and others, discussing a variety of phenomena, including the current humanoid autopsy.
So it hits a really specific mark that I'm into. Yeah, it's great.
About whether the cameraman died.
Oh, I want to ramp off this later.
3rd, 1995 in Los Angeles. A man that matches the name that Centilli had originally given researchers.
Look at this road.
But I talked with
this would be terrifying.
As recently as Thursday, and they said that as far as they were concerned, the cameraman they're dealing with is alive and is under deep cover to protect himself and his family. So that issue is unresolved tonight.
Oh, boy. That gave me a little heart jump. So he's no doubt then still alive, or at least you're...
Yes, they were telling me on Thursday, and as part of the conversation in trying to clarify, is this man alive or not?
I don't know if Art Bell has any, like... presence, like, in the cultural world anymore. But, like, he would come on, like, late night radio sometimes when you'd be driving, and it's just, he's so fun to listen to. Just brings in all these people talking about the craziest shit, and, like, they're dead serious about it, and he treats it with seriousness. So thanks, Abby. It was a lot of fun. I had the goof, what turned into the fucking silly-ass goofy run, but I feel like that's on brand, and I'm cool with it. It was fun, at least. I guess over there. Wish I could turn the car engine sound down.
Footage that has the two six-fingered hands side by side in what is now referred to as the panels or the boxes that the creatures were clutching to their chest, according to the cameraman, when they came on the scene to retrieve them. So now first is Bob Shell.
Yeah, it's so fun, right? And like, this was the 90s, so it was like, there was an earnestness to it. Like, it wasn't like, I don't know, bros making a podcast. Like, he took this shit seriously. Yeah, Coast to Coast with Art Bell. There's a lot on archive.org.
Good. The board in should be here soon.
And can I just ask for a qualifier? Did this friend work in the Inner Sanctum related to MJ-12 or any of the special
projects? That's so cool. Oh, that's probably the next one over there.
Okay. Do you mean that he may have?
I doubt it. I know he knows a lot about this stuff.
Okay, well, I won't interrupt any further. Go ahead.
I don't think he was ever officially involved in it. But anyway, I called him up when I first got into this, and I said, Jim, let me tell you this story. I told him about the film. And And I said, well, I think it is. And he said, well, I figured it was a matter of time. And I said, Jim,
I try and cross
in any personal danger by getting involved. He said, let me get back.
And the engine is soaked. Sorry, Christine, that's how I learned to drive.
He said, Bob, I don't think you have anything to worry about because the thing is one of those hushed up Santilli and the camera both of them.
Oh, it's like Silent Hill Shattered Memories.
I need a vacation.
It was worth it. I wanted to see what happens.
Anything every time
else,
I feel dizzy after
any
this.
Any other information that's come to you from sources verifying it in some way?
Only that I have talked to one man who was referred to me by my other friend.
By Jim.
What?
This man is an active intelligence officer, very high level, who says that he has personally seen one of those control panels, things with the handprint,
right?
Years ago, back in the 60s. And he said he was peripherally involved in a project that was attempting to reverse engineer them. And what they are is computers. And he said that after all the years of research they had done on them, they were no closer to understanding it than they were the first day they laid eyes on.
And the knobs placed in the palm at the bridges of the lower knuckles.
Yeah, because it was because it was AM radio. That's where they put all the ghetto shit.
They impressed one as having some kind of connection to whatever electrical field or nerve impulse there would be.
When he said these things are, the way he put it to me was neuron-based.
Not
electronic, but biological. Which is very curious because there's an article in this month's Discovery magazine talking about building just such a thing. Our computer scientists are working in that direction.
Now,
yeah, I wish I could, like, fix the car sound. It's so loud.
To each of the beings, tailor-made so that whatever their hands and their fields and their telepathic neuron connection to those panels would be their direction.
Let's see if I can get my car back.
He also went on to say that there is the distinct possibility that each panel tailor-made for each being could not be cross-used by another being.
Oh, here we go.
Activate them. It may explain ours why, in the cameraman's statement, he said that he called them the three at the crash site were screaming and clutching these boxes of panels so desperately to their chest.
Absolutely incredible. I mean, that is incredible.
Yes. And the fact that we've been trying to.
I'm going to do it. I'm going to ford the river.
But we haven't gotten much further now than where they
were
50 years ago. Something about the kind of technology
Here, hold on. I gotta turn the game down and Art Bell up.
Yeah, and it goes on because Santilli had told me that in the autopsy on the being that we have not seen, that is under the control of Volker Spielberg in Germany, that the other humanoid had a sort of blemished and shriveled look to the skin, and Santilli had almost, I guess he had just inferred that that was an older being. Well, Bob Shell, in talking about these panels and the individuation of the panels, he said that there is some possible indication that the autopsy that none of us has seen is actually the being that was dead at this crash site when they arrived on the morning of June 3rd, and that what the cameraman photographed in Fort Worth in July of 47, the two beings, and the one that we've seen, that the one we've seen would be the wounded humanoid at the site June 3rd, that Spielberg has the autopsy on the first dead creature, which the cameraman said was put on ice in a truck and hauled off to Wright-Patterson. And the doctors who have...
Oh, speaking of Control, everyone keeps telling me I need to play it, and I need to start taking that seriously, because I actually do really want to play it.
And still have that fluid blood come out from the...
Hey, the holidays are coming. I'll have...
Leaving a two more...
Oh, I will have time.
...for a third one to match the cameraman said he flew
How
back
you...
2 years
oh, there we go.
I'm
going a little too high up.
On another one, leaving in the Bob Shell scenario, one being still alive... And I now want to play for you a message that was left on my message machine after a Dreamland report that I did about 2 weeks ago. And until now, talking with Bob Shell, it didn't make sense. Now I'm going to play it just for all of us to think about.
All right.
The government made contact in 1949 when they returned the alien that survived.
The government made contact in 1949 when they returned the alien that survived.
An anonymous message, I take it.
Yeah, and...
Oh, God.
Yeah, now, maybe...
He's so interested. Right. That's what I love.
There was a fourth surviving being that went back someplace, and that the three autopsies accounted for by the cameraman would be the one dead at the scene, the one injured with the big leg wound, and the third that lived for 2 years. And I'm only putting that out as Bob Shell's hypothesis, but something new to consider as we're all trying to get to the bottom of the truth in all this.
Oh, this is amazing, Linda. You know, something that began as more people than not saying, we think hoax, has been building and building and building and building, and the evidence we've been getting every week now has been toppling over to the side of this really did...
I turn this off.
Yes, and one of the men in the audience in North Haven, who is a medical doctor, his entire profession, he saw the footage last night. We saw the unedited autopsy and debris footage. And he stood up and said that I know something about the Turner syndrome, which has been proposed as a genetic anomaly.
That's the next one.
That I can assure you that there is nothing in this humanoid that would match up to the Turner syndrome. And we've heard that before, but it was interesting to hear it repeated again from
Indeed.
The audience.
All right, Linda, give out all your information, if you would, please. This is a remarkable report. I wish I'd taped it.
Well, thank you. We can go keep doing this more and more.
I wish I'd taped it. Here we are listening to it like 30 years later.
800 number now for people who would like information about my books and videos, and I can give that out.
Okay.
800-707-9993. Again, that's toll free. 800-707-9993. And for people who want to write to me, and you can ask for confidentiality, and I will always honor it, it is Post Office Box 538 in Huntington Valley, Pennsylvania. The zip code is 19006. And again, it's Post Office Box 538, and the city is HUNT, I-N-G, D as in dog, O-N, Valley, P-A, 19006. And my fax number is area code 215-491-9844.
A lot of lampposts, what are you talking about?
I want to advise you, I have received, just prior to airtime, one of the best stories with regard to Bigfoot facts that I've ever received, and I'm going to forward this to you shortly.
Great, because one of the stories I'm working on is a collection of the Bigfoot eyewitness sightings that I've been receiving also since our Dreamland report.
Great, well, I've got to run, but this will be on the way to you, and believe me, it's worth the wait. It'll be there shortly.
Great, maybe I can do this next week.
All right, we'll look for a follow-up. Thank you, Linda.
Talk to you.
Take care. That's Linda Howe. As I said, acknowledged to be the world's expert on crop circles, animal mutilations, and deeply involved, as you can hear, in this autopsy business. And by the way, the wreckage photographs, I repeat, the wreckage photographs, to include, listen very carefully now, the
looking for more satellites
that Linda just talked about, a very, very good resolution picture of those panels, and the bar with the glyph on it, are available on our bulletin board service, which is open now and 24 hours a day. You're welcome to go in there and download one photograph, GIF file, actually, every day, free of charge. That number is area code 702-727-1709. 702-727-1709. 1709. Author of more than, I know it's unbelievable,
it's a long story,
but 100 books on the strange and unknown. Here he draws upon his 40 years as a psychic researcher to select the eeriest, spookiest, scariest, true stories from his own investigations and from his extensive files of paranormal. And
great, we're going to hear some good shit.
Steiger and his wife, Sherry,
okay.
Live in Forest City, Iowa.
I've strayed from the satellites.
Ghosts and Scandinavian pixies. We're going to have to find out what those are. But his latest book, which I do not have a copy of, by the way, is The Awful Thing in the Attic. But you can well imagine that with over 100 books under his belt, that's hard for me to imagine, 100 books under your belt. At any rate, Brad Steiger coming up right after the break. Let me just tell you very quickly that my book, The Art of Talk, is, hopefully you've got a pen and pencil there now. My book, The Art of Talk, is available to be ordered right now.
I really need some kind of map.
This week, shipping this week if you order now. In addition, I poured my heart and soul
into that
book. And I think you're going to love it. It is of the highest quality. It's a hardcover book. And you can order it right now, throughout the night, if you can get through. The number is 1-800-
If you can get through.
864-7991. Take it down. 1-800-864-7991. Now, when we come back, it's off to the strange world of Brad Steiger. This is something I've been waiting for some time to do. Large honor indeed to interview Brad Steiger. It is next.
Oh, good idea.
And the world famous Brad Steiger. Brad, welcome to the program.
Thank you, Art. Pleasure to be with you.
Brad, have you really written over 100 books?
This book is number 134.
Oh my God! I've written the first book in my whole life, which is just coming out, and it drained me and almost killed me. How do you do it?
Good intro.
It's what I do.
Downloading just over the phone. Yeah.
My life. It's my energy.
The early 90s were wild.
Life left after that. It was a killer job for me. Well, anyway.
But you don't have a copy of the book. I can't believe it.
No, I don't. I have a copy of the.
Oh, there's the lighthouse.
Brad Steiger, and In My Soul I Am Free,
yeah.
and that's it so far. So if you are so inclined, I would sure love to have an autographed version.
Well, you certainly will have one, my friend.
All right.
Uh-oh.
First of all,
uh-oh.
I guess a little background on Brad Steiger. How'd you get started with an interest in all of this?
I suppose I'd have to go back to the fact that I was reared in a haunted house.
Mm.
And then I had a near-death experience at age 11.
Oh, boy.
And,
oh, boy.
I guess a visitor from another world or...
Oh, I can't go up there?
When I was five. My best friend Lucy and put all those together, and I guess I had
an early interest.
People think I'm 112 years old, but you have to remember I began riding when I was 15. So people, even my contemporaries, would say, gee,
I'm not going there so bad. Well,
that's true, but I'm not that much older. I'll be 60 now in February.
I see. Well, you don't sound it, number one. And you certainly don't write like it.
That's definitely the only glowing thing on the map.
Why you began writing early.
Yes. I really had no choice, Art. When I was five, and I've told this in a number of books, but I had a close encounter with what today we commonly...
The memorial looks like a mattress.
Being, I didn't know if it was an alpha fairy or whatever. This happened just before I was five. Interestingly, just only recently, I met a woman who now lives in California, who grew up in the neighboring Iowa town next to mine, who had an experience with the same being at the same time, and we knew it was probably the same, or at least a similar being, I should say, because she had an artist commissioned to paint this being. And when I walked into this art gallery, I was overcome, because that was the being. I've had several artists try to replicate as I've described it, but this was absolutely the closest.
Well, do the best you can for us. What was this being, what did it look like?
Well, I grew up on a farm. I'm a country boy. I've lived all over the world, New York, the West Coast, the Arizona, but I'm still a country boy. I love it here in Iowa, the Midwest. So I'm used to seeing, at that time at age five,
puts me back.
I'm used to seeing my father.
At my checkpoint, okay.
So I was awakened. I wasn't awakened, because I'm a night person now, you see.
Yeah, find the hotel.
Your producer said, better take a nap, you up to be midnight. I thought, I'll go to bed before 30. You know?
If my brain compass is working, so it's probably in this direction.
And even as a child, as my mother said, I just could not sleep. I mean, it's just not part of my reality, I guess. So I would sit on the edge of my bed, and in those days, we didn't have electric lights yet. We didn't have radio, we didn't have TV, of course. So, but I would sit on the edge of my bed, and our L-shaped house, I could look in the kitchen window at my parents.
Oh.
I could just kind of hear them. So it's kind of like an early form of television. And I'm sitting
wall.
On the edge of my bed, this is my parents. It's an October night, and I hear the wash tub from the well, as I said, we did not yet have running water, being pulled over under the window.
Mm.
Now, I'm wondering why our massive collie dog isn't just raising all kinds of cane, because a stranger... and remember now, I live in the country. I live way out in the country. It's not like you live in town and you hear the neighbors next door. There are no neighbors next door. Mm-hmm. So when you hear someone at night, you know...
Not good.
No. So I hear the tub being drawn over, and then I see this smallish man, what I first thought was a kind of a helmet on, a very large helmet, and then I saw that that was his head. I mean, he had a very large head, and he was standing looking at my parents in the kitchen, through the kitchen window. And then it's one of those things, we've all done it, you know, stared at the back of somebody's head and they finally turn around.
Sure.
I kept staring at the back of this person's head, this small man's head, or small being's head, I didn't know what. And then that being finally then seemed to sense that the watcher was being watched and turned to look at me. And of course, I will never, as long as I live, forget when he turned and I saw those kind of reptilian, to me, big snake eyes looking at me. Again, this was only from the light from the kitchen window that all I saw was this large, I couldn't really get color.
A lizard man broke into this guy's house to take a bath.
Very large head. I would say it seemed kind of yellowish gray or whatever in the light, looking at me with these very large eyes, and then
definitely the wrong way.
The eyes kept getting, so it seemed to me as a young child now, the eyes kept getting bigger and bigger and bigger until that's all there was for me, was those giant eyes, and then I awakened the next morning.
Well, then somebody would be tempted to say you had a dream.
Someone could easily say that. If that was a dream, Art, it is the only dream I remember from my childhood. It's a dream that I remember with crystal clarity to the age.
Oh, it's moving a little bit.
It's a dream that comes back to me very often. And then, of course, I had this woman who was the same age as I am that I met and did not know as a child growing up because she lived in the neighboring town. And she moved to California when she was rather young. And as I say, we met in this art gallery where she had commissioned an artist to paint the being that came to her when she was a little girl in Iowa. And it was the same or, you know, similar being.
What is it on reflection after all these years that you believe you saw?
I feel I had these things happen to me for a specific reason. The near-death experience, this being, I feel activated something within me. My Indian name, I was adopted into the Seneca tribe, is Hatyaswa, which means he who testifies. And I think I am in a large part with these book art. I think I am a testifier. Now, I was shown, because I have my near-death experience.
That would be fun. There should be like a game about chasing tornadoes.
I am questions answered for me before I was a teenager.
Well, let's move to that.
Hold on. I'm still
near-death. How did that happen?
That happened in a very severe farm accident in which, I mean, the word was already out to prepare the funeral type of thing.
Oh, shit. Oh, it's a lot deeper.
My father and my uncle decided they had nothing to lose. They were going to try to go all the way to Des Moines where they heard there might be someone who could patch me together again.
What happened to you? Can you tell us?
Every time I think
it's extremely gory. I went through a piece of machinery that completely could have decapitated to me, really scalped me, and crushed my skull.
Oh, my God.
So, again, this was on my parents' wedding anniversary. So we were hurrying to get the chores and the work finished so we could go out to eat that night and celebrate their anniversary. And this is how they ended up celebrating. So they decided to make a run. And again, I was in and out of the body. I went up to first a beautiful light. And then I realized that I was dying. And again, the classic, I'm too young to die. I'm 11 years old. And then I thought of my mother. You know, my mother, how's my mother going to receive this? And I was instantly beside her. I thought of my friends. And I was instantly beside each one of them. I was free of the limitations of time and space.
In pain?
No pain. Absolutely no pain. Then, as I said, I was out of the body. If I came back to my body, I would... farther and farther away from my body. It was harder to get back to my body, and I kept moving toward this light, and then I had a moment of panic when I realized I am dying, and I was shown something I cannot put into words. I've written 134 books, thousands of articles and short stories. Words fail me. I was shown a series of geometric designs. The only thing I can say. Seeing those designs somehow told me there was a form, a meaning, a sense to life, and I was in a state of ecstasy.
I've never heard anybody say that before. Geometric design.
Yeah, what is this?
I've heard a lot of testimony about near-death, but never geometric designs.
I've lectured, and sometimes people in the audience will, of course, there'll be just one or two.
Oh, it's like cyberpunk.
I know what you're talking about, and I can't put it in words either.
Do you remember those things, kaleidoscopes, when you were a kid and you would turn them?
Yes.
Was it that kind of effect?
No. The closest I've seen, my wife, Sherry, does a healing seminar using fractal geometry. And the fractals that she projects, and she has marvelous results in the audience of people being spontaneously healed with this, are the closest that I've seen to these designs. At any rate, then, I was told or given to understand that I was to go back on the body, into the body. I came back into the body just as they were about to operate. And I was a very husky 11-year-old boy. And I remember sitting up, pushing two interns against the wall, and it was a Roman Catholic hospital. And one of the nurses then began to speak to me in a very soothing voice. And I've always, I guess, related to the feminine principle. And she's managed to call me And what? Then I went to a beautiful place where they did the surgery.
Oh, here we go.
A beautiful valley filled with marvelous people and so forth. Who kind of kept
take a look at this real quick, and then we'll take the body this time the other direction.
So you once again left. In other words, you came back, you actually became conscious, then once again unconscious.
Right.
I take it they gave you a general, and under you went, and away you went.
Yes. The nun then managed to call me. My first
beer, cheaper than gas.
In my room was a child who was dying when I recovered consciousness in a couple of days. And the nuns in this Roman Catholic hospital seemed to understand that I had been someplace, that I'd had this near-death experience. So, of course, they
kind of spooky, the flag flapping around.
And they asked me to speak to the parents. The child was already in kind of a comatose state, and to assure them, you know, that their child would be going to a beautiful place, that I had been there and I had seen it, and I was able to bring them comfort. And somehow at age 11, then that's what got me started. I realized if I shared these things, that it could bring people hope, inspiration.
Yes.
Okay, comfort, so you can see the signs super far ahead of time through the fog. That's helpful.
We are souls inhabiting a fleshly body. There's more to
us right here.
Even the most imaginative of us can believe.
Okay, I've heard, as a matter of fact, they even did a piece on this on 2020 or 60 Minutes, forget what it was.
Okay.
They had a doctor say, well, we believe this area that people go to, or this light they see, is the brain which is dying from the outside in. Mm-hmm. And as the outside dies, you see this core of light, which is in fact the core of your brain. In an attempt to explain it medically.
All right.
If you were standing in front of that doctor and listening to that, what would
you
say?
Level one complete.
Well, I guess one thing I would say is you haven't been there. It's fine to theorize about these things.
Yes.
And you know, I have the most beautiful imitation rose sitting in front of me, but it's not real. We can imitate, we can replicate, but then there's the real. Then there is that which is transformative. There is that which tells us that what we really know in our hearts, that we are more than physical things.
And so that's how strongly you feel about it. You would just
yeah,
say
the hard car was idling all night.
Well,
it's cool. Don't
I
worry.
I think you understand. I've really stopped arguing
Windland Plains
with people at this point.
Because there's no point.
There's no point. I have had, and you know, I certainly am a human being who enjoys, I don't like to say I told you so, and I try not to. But I've had, over the years, Art, so many people laugh at me because I talk about UFOs, laugh at me because I talk about ghosts,
I know.
Who then, after they've had their experience, they return, and they don't care who argues with them because they've seen. Now they know. They have experienced. So I taught college for a number of years, and the bright young ladies in the department used to set me up with a scientist, so every lunch for me became a debating society. And when I was young and earnest, I did that. I debated,
shit.
I debated, and tried to sway with intellect and knowledge and footnotes. And now I realize these are individual mystical experiences. And once you have had one, you cannot be dissuaded. You cannot be told. You don't care what someone thinks or someone believes or disbelieves, because you know it is that noetic sense of knowing. It's beyond reason. Beyond intellect.
Yeah, it must be a great comfort. Brad, hold on one moment. We'll be right back to you. My guest is Brad Steiger. Stay right where you are.
I put that forth in my books in the late 60s, and at that time, people weren't ready. I mean, friends like J. Allen Hynek and so forth said, man, you are really off the deep end. These are solid, clunk-clunk, physical. And, of course, Sherry was Allen Hynek's manager right up to the very end working with him. And he came very much to see the multidimensional, the paraphysical dimension.
What's
and
this?
Like I say, I have chased these beings, if you will, all over the world. And
what I have witnessed with my own eyes, and of course we know, I think it was, what? I don't remember who it was, Arthur C. Clarke or someone who said that the science of, you know, an advanced generation would look like magic to us.
Mm-hmm.
So nothing I can say is dogmatic, so please understand that. It seems what I have seen with my own eyes and my own experience.
Two chairs leaning over a hole. Oh, they got a nice bed.
More than it seems to be physical, but I'm not.
Someone lives here.
Physical. I would never do that. But I'm saying the bulk of what we see, I think, is multidimensional or paraphysical.
Cute place for a weekend.
We're not gonna have time for you to answer this completely right now. But I had on my program the other day an individual, and I've had faxes from individuals.
That should be the sequel, River Patrol.
This sounds crazy, and it sounds like a TV series revisited. But they firmly, literally claim they are immortal. People who claim their aging process has halted. Is there such a thing in your view?
I think there are ascended masters who walk among us. I think the striving for immortality or reversing the aging process, I think at this point, I think I know to whom you're referring. I don't think it happened yet. Time will tell, but I don't think we're going to see these people being able to demonstrate what they hope to.
A lot of them are not interested in demonstrating anything at all.
Mm-hmm.
They figure that they'll end up being guinea pigs if they...
Mm-hmm.
So I've been approached anonymously. I was just curious.
Well, I think... Okay, maybe... I would say that I think there may be such timeless beings walking among us.
Whoa, that was the question. All right,
yeah,
Brad. Stand by. You've got several minutes, so just...
We're big guy.
Okay. Right back to you. This, of course, from near the area there. Brad, welcome back.
Thank you.
He's melting right through the windmill.
With that many books under your belt, I don't know where to begin except having had the early childhood experiences that launched
you into
this
guy.
And just joined us at this hour. You must have studied quite a few haunted houses.
Mm.
Haunted houses.
Where am I trying to bring them?
Have absolutely fascinated me all my life.
Yes.
What story would you relate, or stories, of the best cases of haunting that you've run?
Just says they should be redirected, not really where.
I would probably have to. I'm not good at choosing the best when I.
Oh, where'd he go? He's so fast.
So many. I know you understand that.
Sure.
I would relate, probably, you know, maybe kind of do a pastiche here.
All right, good.
What I've tried to do in this book, this current book, it is a collection of some of my favorite hauntings. And you put your finger on something, though, Art. I think when we talk about haunted houses, no matter how scary, if we see a movie about haunted houses or ghosts, you know, on one level, they are telling us something very positive, that there is life after death, that something survives.
That's right.
So, in the haunted houses, I really began with the whole idea, I mean, I was like a botanist. If I heard a rare flower was blooming in Brazil, then I went there to be there when the moon came up. So that was my attitude. I wanted to investigate as many as possible. And in those days, as I say, I was extremely intellectual. I mean, I was rationalizing, explaining away everything. And then I ran up against things that, you know, could not be explained by squirrels in the attic or knocking water pipes. I mean, things that really were on the ken.
Sure.
One of the houses we investigated, I'll start with this one. I find it one of the most dramatic.
All right.
Because I was, along with several other 200-pound men, lifted into the air by this entity.
He's getting away.
This was a situation where a number of murders over the years...
What's the goal? I'm not sure, but I'm supposed to drive these guys away from a city.
Vibrations or energies that exist.
I don't know how to...
Some people
I don't know, like,
know when they move
what exactly I'm supposed to do to accomplish that.
And somehow they end up replicating the terrible deed that was done before. Well, this happened to be the case with this house. And in this, there had been a double murder in
the gotta be, like, right in front of them.
Double murder in the basement. When we were called by the police and others to investigate, most of the phenomena were taking place in the basement. The woman would go down, turn on the faucets, and blood would come pouring out of the faucets. There seemed to be faces on the wall. There seemed to be things happening. But then this one back room in which the murder had taken place, Both murders were of a jealous husband who came home and blew his wife and the lover away with a shotgun, even though it may have been a generation apart.
Most hauntings, Brad, seem to be, I've noticed, because of unrequited love, because of a violent...
Ah, got him. Now what?
What do you think happens?
Now he's probably pissed.
Is that the soul is somehow unable to move on?
I still have to intellectualize things. You have to bear with me.
You just flash him and then that's it. Okay.
I used to, when someone said a soul waiting to move on, I thought, oh, no, come on.
This game is very simple, and I'm totally down with it.
The case in some hauntings. I think when we're dealing with a ghost phenomenon...
Flash him, then you go somewhere else. Now we gotta go to Shallow Lakes.
Ghost is a photograph
northeast from Woodville.
Replicates itself in the environment. People say, why are these
if we find Shallow Lakes or Woodville, we're good to go.
There are happy ghosts. I've gone to places and I hear from people all the time who have a ghost that they consider like a member of the family.
I've heard that too.
Yeah. So again, there are happy ghosts, but the ones that we seem to hear about, without question, happen around violent death, as you said, of some nature. Great emotion involved, and unfortunately, too often the emotion of hatred. So in this particular case, now, did I answer your question? I'm sorry.
Instead of fixing her, well, I think you did, but you threw a chicken in it when you talked about happy ghosts, and
I
have heard of them. So what does that add up to?
Oh, no
does
way.
Add up to some souls who want to be here can be here, otherwise...
Well, I don't have any final answers. I have to put them in categories, my friend.
All right.
I have to say that there are those in which it seems there is a malignant energy.
Yes.
Sometimes I think the house itself hates people.
Yeah.
I mean, I think there is an energy within a house. It may have nothing to do with the people involved, but somehow it poisons the people involved. And for example, almost every major hotel, I don't know if you know this or not, I've run into this, has what they call the suicide room. Did you know that?
Have you heard of the Miss Powell Hotel here in Nevada?
No, but that may be one, huh?
It is one.
Okay.
It is one.
Where suicides happen, someone comes in, they feel depressed, they don't know, and they suddenly feel encouraged, they feel motivated to do the act. So you know what I'm talking about.
Yes.
There seems to be a residue of emotion in some places. In this particular house, I went into the back room with a psychic medium to try to get some impressions, and the door kept trying to close. Now, to close, Art, it had to move uphill. Because
okay,
this is an
we're looking
old
for
in the
Shallow Lakes,
you know, the
or Woodville.
So it had to move uphill, and then it had to, part of the cement kind of stopped it. So it normally, even if it did blow in the wind, it would be stopped by this little raising part segment of the floor. But this would move itself and try to close and lock me in to the room. Now, I had a friend of mine, Husky, former Green Beret, who's buddy always goes with me, used to go in these cases. There are some other good-sized men there.
Goes back in this direction.
The door open, you know, don't let it close, because we're trying to pick up impressions here.
Sure.
When we finished, I said, okay, the darn door wants to be locked or closed, close it and lock it. Well, that was the wrong thing to say, and I said it with a little too much of an attitude.
I see.
We went upstairs. We were just starting to pick up impressions in other parts of the house, and all of a sudden, bam, we hear in the basement. And then it sounds like King Kong coming up from those basement stairs, one by one.
Oh, that's where I'd be going.
The door, then, from the basement, throws itself open, and every one of us in the room were lifted into the air and then dropped. As if to say, watch your mouth, sonny. I ran immediately down to the room that we had just locked, and the door had literally been thrown off its hinges.
Oh my God! I see.
They need to get me an SUV.
How did you manage at that point even stay where you were? I mean, my feet would be saying, "Get me out of here."
In those places, Art, I have to dissociate myself.
Okay, I think I just come straight through here.
Through meditation, through prayer.
Didn't I backtrack?
And this can be carried too far, and My wife is certain that I don't carry it, but I can enter a mental state where I just shut off my emotions, my reactions, and so forth, and just kind of become a camera, you know, recording what
I'm observing. An observer.
An observer. I'm in the scene, but I'm observing the scene. And I think that's part of being a writer, too, because everything that happens to me, I know someday is grist for my mill. Everything that happened to me, someday I'm going to write about it. But again, I have to, and my wife is very good about saying, "Hey, now, no, you're not the Brad machine." Some of my friends have called me when I get into that. Oh, the Brad machine is taking over. So I, you know, you're not the Brad machine now. You're back with us, and so forth. But in those cases, I have to, or like you say, I mean, I guess what it did for me too, because I had intellectualized it so much, I realized here again,
there's sign over
my
there.
Massive intellect didn't help at all in that case. I mean, that door went flying off its hinges. Something came up, something you could not understand, something you couldn't put in the test tube, something you couldn't put in the formula and explain away. There was an intelligence, there was a force, there was an energy in that house that didn't want to be messed with.
How many, obviously.
It wanted to be respected.
How many of you, yeah, respected, how many of you were lifted into the air?
Oh, let's see. It must
no,
have been, three women and four or five men.
Wow.
And each of us men were 200 pounders.
Uh-huh.
All at once, my friend.
So you had insulted this entity.
Yes, I had. Mm. Yes, I had. And I have learned to be circumspect since. I was young then. I was much younger then. Well, then the exploration of different houses, different areas. Again, you were talking, you know, how do we said... I said, I don't try to convince people anymore. There was this one, the house again.
Oh, there's a Woodville sign.
The police asked us to investigate at the time.
Here, check this out.
Because so many phenomena. This was a marvelous home, beautiful home, in which a former local politician had lived. And when he passed away, his two maiden daughters lived there until their death. But several people had seen every night... from the field in which the old stable had been.
Bam.
Papa would materialize, walk across
the log
to the house, and then you could hear the daughters talking to Papa. I mean, he would come back.
All I had to do was activate a checkpoint on the other side.
Getting up in years
no problemo. I'm a filthy cheater.
To them, they simply went back in time, and it was Papa coming in from checking the horses and having a normal evening with them. So... we investigated. The caretaker was very cooperative. The police officer who had put me onto the case, you know, was a good friend. He'd taken crop circle pictures for me. He'd taken he was the eye in the sky, you know,
sure.
The traffic airplane cop.
Yes, of
the eye in the sky.
Right.
So he was going to be with me. He was the one that had set that up. And I say he's been very cooperative,
hey Jasper,
providing me, flying different places,
outside,
investigating UFOs. He suddenly had to be somewhere else.
Would.
He was shifted in his duty roster.
Northeast.
And a police officer took his place who thought we were all crazy.
This is actually kind of the right direction.
So he was with us during the day and thought, you know, he just never resisted a chance, Art, to give me the needle.
Do that way-ish.
So that night, we're standing out there, the place where Papa... is supposed to materialize or has been seen. And right as clockwork, you see these like little sparkly lights starting to swirl. And the policeman says to me, "What's that?" I said, "I don't see anything." Couldn't resist. It kept forming and forming until in front of us is this image, ghostly sparking image of a man. And the police officer
Woodville.
Is going out of his head because I keep saying, "I don't see anything, officer." I couldn't resist because he's been giving me the needle all day.
Huh.
So just at the time he's pulling out his service revolver, I say, no. I said, "I see it. I'm sorry." But I said, "You kind of had it coming." He said, "Yeah, I guess I kind of did." But he says, "What in hell are we seeing?" That's the first time I've ever put my hand in a ghost. I couldn't resist because the image was so tangible, like a hologram being projected.
I'm sure shooting at it would have been poorly advised.
Poorly advised, but I did stick my fingers into it, and it was a tingly, cold feeling. You know, like we feel the cold spot in haunted houses.
Kind of like I've got on my spine. Brad, hold there for just a second. Oh, boy, if that doesn't raise the hackles on the back of your... Huh. Tingly, huh? Well, I'm going to take you now to another world, inside your body. These are called pycnogenes. The hand into an entity and a tingling feeling.
Mm-hmm. Can I hear something?
Now, see, you must have been in the classic Steiger mode, because there's no way in the world that I'd put my hand inside any entity.
But I have this insatiable curiosity.
Yeah, obviously. Obviously. You're lucky to still be here from my point of
view. Oh.
Well, I've been told that.
Nothing's moving.
I'm sure you have. So, did you just hold your hand in there or pull it out or what?
I was respectful. I'd learned respect by that time.
Oh, my God.
And I just had to. I mean, it was such a, where are you going to get an opportunity like this again? The majority of hauntings are sounds, their feelings, their moans, their groans.
Yes.
You just sound them, you know, you get a really good materialization of that.
The physical manifestation.
Right, right. So, again, it paid me no attention, which, again, as I say, I have to put them into categories. This was like a strip of film art that was being reactivated and did the same thing every night. It walked then into
Is it heading for Woodville?
Didn't open the door, but made the motion. And
was he going to destroy the train?
And, was then moving about. You could see the light. It was illuminated, and you could see it moving from room to room in the house. Now, again, we had a number of police officers. Again, interestingly, a couple police officers came back after we had left and had the same experience.
Did they
burned rubber?
Got him.
That would have been my reaction, right? Did they make a report on this, or how did they handle this officially?
No. Again, as I say, the majority are situations where the police or someone has called us in to try to determine, do an exorcism if it's possible.
Where's he going?
To my knowledge, even though these are police officers who have, read my books, who have made contact, who believe in a larger reality.
You're probably, though, the last turn they make in trying to...
Oh, of course. Yeah. Of course. And that seems unfair on one level, but I understand that. I understand that, because everyone wants to explain it. And first you go to your chief and say, we have a haunting here, and he says, right, you've been working too hard, maybe you better take some leave. So this was almost all done unofficial, but I can say I've done it with police captains, lieutenants, chiefs of entire areas in major cities across the United States, but it's all done on the QT, unofficially.
All right, and this graveyard. Is going to be unofficial too, Brad. Nicole Brown Simpson and Ron Goldman died terrible physical deaths.
Physical
O.J.
deaths.
Has been acquitted of those murders. Mm-hmm. Nevertheless, they died terrible deaths.
Mm-hmm.
Would you expect that to be the kind of case? And I'm going to hold this.
I think they're gone.
The hook. We're at the bottom of the hour. But I'm going to ask you when we come back if you would expect that to be the kind of case that would produce after energy.
I'd be very pleased to answer that.
Good. And you will when we come back. We'll be right back.
Get it straight now. Young woman is going to what is...
I think I want to go right.
Give me a minute.
Hi, Syndragon.
Anyway, she goes to this particular office.
Oh, here's the guy. Hello.
And much as the case you related, suddenly when she
It's atmospheric.
There,
I wouldn't say it's really, scary.
She even looks out the window. It's not the campus of today. It's the campus of many years ago.
Oh,
a woman is sitting at the desk, smiles, a very tall woman, a very elegant woman, stands up, walks toward her as if to say,
oh, won't let me out.
Help you. And I think it was in one of the music rehearsal or practice rooms, was at one time then part of the administration. So,
what we're listening to is not part of the game. We're listening to Art Bell.
She had gone back in
coast
time
to coast.
When she described it. So eventually then, in a couple generations old yearbook, they found the woman that she had seen, who was a faculty member and described as very statuesque. And it was the picture of the woman she had seen. They were able to trace it. They were able to go back. So
statuesque.
Here again, she had literally walked back in time. I've had other cases in hotel rooms where people, again, have walked onto another floor where obviously it's another time. It's a fascinating, fascinating area.
Is it worth trying, if somebody wanted to actually try to travel in time, I remember how it was done in Somewhere in Time, eliminate every possible reference to the current modern world, and then went into a state of strong concentration and in despair, and then finally at the right moment, of course, he did travel in time. I wonder, do you think that is possible?
I think it is possible. Now, we did it through hypnosis. We did this live on television.
You did?
Yes, we did. An ABC, if I may mention.
You may.
And I didn't realize.
ABC, if I may mention.
We had done a number of experiments in time travel.
Oh, and I'm not done.
Out of body projection. We first went.
I gotta keep chasing him.
Experiment on one show, which was live on TV, so there's nothing you can do, man. It's live.
Yeah.
So you're really, I mean, talk about pressure. So
I'll fuck my car up, though.
To the host, who was taking over for the regular host, to his home in Boston. Not only did the subject describe his home exactly, described and looked at the makes of the various utilities and so forth, but then all of a sudden it began to describe people coming in the front door. And a man thought his wife was alone home.
Zipping a sippy
during
drink.
Commercial, he called his wife because he said, those sound like our friends from New Hampshire. And sure enough, at that very moment, these friends had dropped by unexpectedly while we were projecting our subject there. They challenged us then on another show, and they had experts in the audience, to go back to Lincoln's Gettysburg address. To send our subject back there and describe, and there are a number of Lincoln scholars. So any detail, well, our subject came up with several details.
Incredible. Again, we're at the bottom of the hour, but it brings up again the question, who's the ghost? Maybe,
exactly.
Maybe we are. Thanks, Brad. Stay right there.
Who's the ghost? Maybe we are. What if ghosts are just time travelers? I'm into it.
This hour of Art Bell was recorded for rebroadcast at this time. Please do not call.
Art Bell is taking calls on the wildcard line.
Art Bell.
At 702-727-1295. That's 702-727-1295.
I'm going, like, not.
First time callers can reach Art Bell at 702-727-1222. 702-727-1222.
Now,
Art Bell.
I've made a deal with Mr. Steiger. 30 more minutes, he's all mine. Top of the hour after the news, he's all yours.
Oh, there he is.
The lines in. Hang tight, everybody.
There's Mr. Man.
Good night. All right, back now to the very much world-famous Brad Steiger. And, Brad, we cut ourselves a little deal here. I absolutely love... I'm an animal lover. I love cats. And I guess your wife has authored... did she author or co-author with you a book on animals?
Yes, we have co-authored Strange Powers of Pets. Strange Powers of Pets. And now the new one, The Mystery of Animal Intelligence. And she feels especially proud of this one because this was written for the teenage audience. It is be a selection of scholastic books, so you know the kids get that right in the school with their catalogs and so forth, or will be on in bookstores as well too. And this is all 100% scientific research, The Mystery of Animal Intelligence. And then part of the deal, she...
What is the... before you leave it, I want to understand a little bit about it. What is the premise? How does it approach trying to understand animal intelligence?
What we're trying to do in this book is to gain a respect for animal intelligence. We have many recognized zoologists, biologists, so forth, who say that animals are strictly conditioned reflexes.
Zoologists. Zoologists.
Let me stop you right there. I talked to somebody not very long ago.
Wonderful.
Who said, you know, if I see a raccoon or a rabbit and I'm driving down the street, I swerve and I squish them every time I get a chance. Yeah. You know, I thought when I heard that, Brad, if a person, to me, that's almost as much of a sin personally as killing a human being. Now, obviously it isn't, but the intentional, mindless taking of life.
How dare we? I mean, how dare that person, you know, have such a callous attitude, careless attitude toward life?
Just for the fun of it.
So what this book is, again, is talking to those scientists, those zoologists, biologists, animal trainers, and so forth.
Step on me.
Instances of a reasoning capacity of animals using tools.
Oh, he's not,
tools,
like, tangible.
Animals,
okay.
You know, doing things that other people, like this man you're talking about, would not think animals were capable of doing. So it's really a very rich book, and as I say, it was done specifically for the teenage or the educational market.
Big rock golem.
We were delighted. I mean, they started with the first printing of nearly 150,000 on it. So the schools, and this is what her, because again, she, you know, with her educational background and ministerial background,
are we in the oil fields?
The young people,
oh, there's Bright City.
Indeed.
Or at least that looked like
the title
it.
Again?
The Mystery of Animal Intelligence.
Mystery of Animal Intelligence. And how would people get that?
Well, it should be in all of the stores. It is a tour book, and then the Scholastic people are going to feature it in the will be right in the schools where the kids can order it. So the parents can be on the lookout for it and see that their child order it. And then she has her book of inspiration called Seasons of the Soul.
You guys kind of going straight for the city that I'm supposed to be keeping it away from.
800 number,
which is
800-7.
Well, now he's across a fence, so I'm fucked.
3454.
All right. I'm curious. Your research. How do you decide? Your time has to be very valuable in a lot of cases, and mail, and I'm sure pleas for help come your way. How do you decide what to pursue?
Oh, that's so hard. And to be frank, I can't do it the way I used to, and I don't have
can't flash them.
I've gone literally every state, every province in Canada, and in many, many places around the globe.
Wow, it's only 7.
I had to limit that to some degree. I put a lot of things on tape now for people. In the same way with the books, I'm trying to relate more. We dropped off the lecture circuit 2 years ago.
It's gruesome, isn't it?
Well, not to say that we won't do it again, Art, but, you know, we were gone 2-3 weeks out of the month. We love people. We love people. And we love the seminar and lecture situation, but we really thought we kind of have to retreat. We kind of have to really focus on some of the books that we think are important to get out and really work our ministry that way. We still do work individually when the occasion arises, but I can't go to as many houses, haunted houses, as I used to, though. I mean, even if I'm sitting in the dental chair, someone will come in.
Sure.
I have this incredible thing happening in my house. Huh. You have to help me. And you know,
it's like black and white. Okay.
We'll always be and always want to be suckers for humanity. I mean, we love people. We want to work with people as much as we can. But I'll just be frank. You know, I've had to limit it in recent years with other demands on our time.
All right. Segue again. This is an area that I'm recently very curious about, and I used to laugh about it, kind of. You know, all these tales about Bigfoot. You heard Linda Moulton Howe
Bigfoot
Greenland
time.
When you were our guest this last week.
Fuck these fences.
She has a tape of a scream of a creature, allegedly Bigfoot, Brad, and I have never, I mean, I've heard it 4 or 5 times now because I keep making her play it. It is the most blood-curdling, horrible, anti-human.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's just. Is there
play it.
A
play the. Play the scream.
Like, is there Bigfoot?
Well, there certainly is something, because again.
Is there Bigfoot?
In my younger days, and I had some buddies who were, you know, rangers and experienced woodsmen. And,
I feel like I'm not supposed to be on this side of the fence.
And we would take up on a moment's notice, and we have gone all over. And I've heard him, and I've smelled him, and I've found the droppings, and I've picked up the hair.
Oh, he smelled Bigfoot.
And we've been in situations where people, I mean, there are 30 men with 30-30s and 30-06s ready to go out. We found the dead cattle. We found the dogs.
Yeah, I'll check with the motel.
Broken in half. There's something there for a while, but I'm becoming more and more convinced that, again, it's multidimensional or paraphysical.
Something in, something out.
Something in, something out. Because, I mean, we've been in situations where that nothing could have got away. I mean, there...
See, this is what's fun about this podcast. It's like, the subject matter that's been discussed has been time travel through hypnosis and ghosts and Bigfoot and UFOs. And no matter what you ask this guy, is like, do you believe in such and such? The answer is yes. And that's why it's fun.
I mean, I remember friends in Canada sent me, I guess it became kind of a popular tune, Old Daddy.
Fuck.
Old Daddy Bigfoot, I think it was. Hit the charts for a while in Canada a few years
ago.
Oh,
there's a map. I didn't know this was here.
I'll tell you this story, which I've never put into print.
All right.
Maybe I should, like, keep this up somewhere.
We thought, I mean, this was in an area.
Yeah, I'll feel better with it.
Was creating havoc with the farmers and killing cattle and their dogs. We managed to get a clump of hair, and we took it to a very well accredited forensic scientist with a major university.
Yes.
When we came back to pick it up, the man was mad as blazes at us, and he said, "Don't get me involved in this type of thing." And we said, "Well,
what do you mean?"
Yeah, we kind of explained to him what it was. He says, yeah, right.
So far away.
And, well, what's the trouble? He says, "Well, you're trying to get me involved in some divorce proceedings, aren't you?"
Huh?
We said, "What do you mean?" We said, "Well, this is, I mean," he says, it appears to be human or, and human-like. I mean, and obviously you got this in somebody's bed and now you're trying to bring me. So, I mean, he wouldn't even talk to
us. Oh, it's way out there.
But we were intrigued. In other words, it misled this top forensic scientist.
Yeah, I don't think I can get there where he went.
All the time at one of the major universities.
Well, no, wait. I'm a little unclear. He was saying it was human-like.
I think we were here.
First he said it was human hair.
Yeah.
And then when we said, "No, wait, wait."
I wish the motel was mapped.
We told you where we found it.
Oh, Grand Rock. Oh, it's, yeah, it's right in the middle.
Yeah.
And but we knew it was because of the footprints of Bigfoot. And he said, "This is human hair. What are you trying to pull on me?" So that really baffled us.
But our clue tells us to go to shallow lakes.
So that threw another bizarre thing in it, because it was long, it was coarse, but it still...
I don't know how I'm going to find it again.
It convinced him that it was enough like human that he thought he was being involved unknowingly in a divorce case.
You have talked many times of disappearances. I keep going back to movies, but I recently saw The Langoliers, which I guess the whole rest of the world saw some time ago. I went and actually rented it.
I go roughly northeast.
Again, it comes back to either a dimension or a time slip, or I'm not exactly sure what it is, but there are
the Langoliers that fucking...
They're very hard to account for people who just suddenly, literally blink out.
Stephen King miniseries.
The chapter in my book, Men and Women,
it's very fun, except for the famously god-awful CGI right at the end.
In my book, Awful Thing in the Attic, because as I said, that's
I'm just gonna cheat.
Favorite topics, and a man here, Minnesota, I believe it was, sent me a remarkable case that I include there.
Yeah, I saw that on cable once, long ago.
Here, if we follow it. He
conceptually, it's very fun, too.
His house one day, walking in the field, and then suddenly saw or was aware that it wasn't quite his field. And he looked around and
like
it was
it's a fun setup I really love. Like his normal imagine waking up on an airplane
right.
And like
and the more he
90%
walked,
of the people who were on the plane are just gone.
So similar, but almost like an echo or a shadow of where he should walk.
Right.
Now, again, I think we can link this in with the legends of the wee people or the elves. I think there is that Middle Earth. I mean, again, quote, around Middle Earth. But that other dimension, that magic theater that is all around us. I think we can walk into those dimensions.
Okay, and is it, does that Middle you Earth. Wrap a lot of this into that Bigfoot Loch Ness?
Well, I think
no copyright infringement intended.
The pictures, the photographs, like I say, we've had the droppings, we have the hair, we have the footprints, but we don't have the entity itself. I remember years ago, and are you familiar with the name Bernard Hevelmans or Ivan Sanderson?
I am not.
Well, Bernard Hevelmans is the
I think this is south, actually. I should probably go this
who
way.
Who has written a number of books on cryptozoology.
Yes.
Ivan Sanderson was one of my mentors. He was a regular on the Gary Moore morning show. He was the zoologist that came on like people do, whether it's David Letterman or Johnny Carson.
Yes.
In an earlier time, it was Ivan T. Sanderson, who was a world-renowned. He was originally from Scotland. He was a zoologist. And I remember the late-night phone call I got, and Ivan says, you know, I have found it, lad. At last I have what I have searched my life, and Bernie is here with me, and they're in the northern part of Minnesota, and they found what they believed at last was the corpse of Bigfoot.
Wow.
Now, suddenly, that became involved in one of the most incredible mysteries. Whatever happened, now, I saw it not too long ago on Unsolved Mysteries, and there was someone portraying Ivan and Bernard, and again, it ended up, they thought it was a mask from Planet of the Apes from Hollywood. But again, here we have two eminent zoologists. Who the stink of the body, the feel of the body. But suddenly when other scientists came, here was this rubber dummy. Now what happened to their theory is, and again, you know, not to get anybody in any type of trouble, but as someone told me,
well, this wasn't here yesterday.
The person, one of the people responsible, let's put it that way, because I don't want trouble for anybody, that the person felt that he had actually shot a human being and arranged to dispose so that there would not be charges brought.
Uh-huh.
Also, of course, it is unlawful to display a corpse.
Hey, Jasper.
So this person may have felt that he was going to get nailed on two counts and did the switch. But I know that Ivan and Bernard and a few others, eminent zoologists, were in large sense discredited and in some sense never recovered. And it wasn't, Ivan didn't live long after that experience.
You know Professor John Mack, I take it?
Yes.
John Mack has gone through tribulation recently with Harvard,
mm-hmm.
which was attempted to tamper a bit with his credentials.
Oh, I thought
it
was on the car was inside here. Oh, there it is.
Nearly up on charges. For investigating the alien abduction or abduction
actually
syndrome.
This isn't too bad.
And I guess I wanted to ask you a little
look
bit
at the map.
About that and put you out on the same sort of limb regarding people who claim
I think if I just turn around
they are taken. Brad, what do you think of this? These people.
I'm like the worst streamer of these kinds of games because I really do just like to hang out and wander.
Into the earth, they've been taken by alien beings or beings of some kind.
I think again, I started writing.
I'll make a big old production out of it. I'm just vibing. Oh, there's the motel.
Long before it was popular, and I became very unpopular in research groups for writing about it. People felt I shouldn't deal with this, that it was nonsense. It
makes people angry.
Yes. Now, of course, it's almost de rigueur, you know.
Trivial.
I don't have too much patience with those who claim that, you know, 40 million people have been abducted. I think, certainly, that...
Hey, but, like, actually, this game
is very
cool, though.
I think most of the cases happen, again, on the mental level. I think in out-of-body type experiences. There are so many similarities between the abduction experience and some near-death experiences, for example.
Oh, it's true, but I'll move you from there right into the hardware.
Yeah, blanket time,
fuck
yeah. This
is from Rick in Reno. He says, Art, I don't know if you're aware of this.
Oh, shit.
I wasn't, but Brad co-wrote Al
Bielek's book, The Philadelphia Experiment, other UFO conspiracies. Actually, I think he probably did about 90% of the writing. And
maybe Rick, could cross
like
the fence.
How much credibility you attach to the Bielek story?
I'm gonna write a review of this game, and one of the things is gonna be that there's too many fences.
A real story of hardware and time.
Yeah.
So.
Debbie Caprice has serious capabilities. You know what? You know what really has serious capabilities is this guy. This incredible driver right here.
When I did
fearless.
The Allende letters in the
cannot be stopped except for this fence.
Book on the Philadelphia experiment then.
Which is actually becoming a problem.
It grew out of an article.
Trying to get north.
For Saga magazine. Remember that wonderful magazine?
I do.
And it brought me
put that
the
button
most
there.
Incredible mail. Of people who claim to have had relatives on board, of people who claim themselves to have been on board, of families who claim they had relatives in institutions after the experiment.
Yes, sir.
I have to say that something happened.
I chased one titan. It was a wyvern. It was very cute.
Was the one who quietly provided me with
we just helped it get home.
Information and research.
I honestly didn't think these would have like
become
tangibility.
My wife and I were probably the only people other than two or three relatives at his mother's funeral, for example.
It would seem we are at the oil fields.
We love this man, and we've had him in our home.
And there's Bright City. So we're on the opposite side of the map of where we need to be.
He was a participant.
Yes.
I'll
leave it there, but
all I want to say is every time I think there's nothing to this story, someone in whom I put a great deal of credence comes up with another piece of the jigsaw puzzle.
So, in other words, something happened.
Something happened. And whether people so identify with it that they become absorbed or...
All right, we've got to hold it there. Rest. We'll be back. And when we are, it's your turn.
Oh, I don't know if anything's anything. You know? Is anything real?
This hour of
invisible wall? Okay, I'm done.
At this time, please do not call.
There's my car. Art Bell Music.
West of the Rockies at 1-800-618-8255. 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies at 1-800-825-5033. 1-800-825-5033. This is the CBC Radio Network.
It certainly is. My guest, the incredible, the world-famous Brad Stein.
I think you're asking the car.
Psychologically. Or who brought in discordant energies that really raised Cain. And I've had this happen with Phi Beta Kappas. I've had this happen with Dean's List A students who again thought intellectually they were superior to all this nonsense.
Yes.
And just were almost psychologically destroyed. So I say don't play around with it.
Suppose somebody said, all right, fine, I take it seriously. I want to try to examine this world as Brad Steiger and others have done. I want a serious approach to it. How do you then advise them? We're not going to party it up, but we do want to try a seance, or we do want to try a Ouija board or something like that. Then what would you say?
Well, again, I'd be terribly arrogant if I said no one else should approach it that way but me and a few others. I would never say that because I think this enters into an area of what I call personal shamanism. I think
okay, Woodville, we do want to go there.
I think that we have the ability to reach out and touch higher intelligences, but this must be done again with prayer. Shaman friends of mine, you know, who fast before they try this, who fast, go through a period of discipline, who go through prayer. I think it requires, I'm serious, I think it requires that same kind of attitude that you become ministers, so to speak, that you become priests, that you become shamans, that you really approach this area with that kind of seriousness and that kind of responsibility. Mm-hmm. And then you have every right as a sovereign entity for you to expand your universe as well.
Just move carefully.
Move carefully.
Uh-huh.
Move
right.
carefully.
West of the Rockies, you're on the air with Brad Steiger. Good evening.
Hello.
Hello.
You're hitting mute here.
All right.
Yeah, it's about symmetrical objects. I mean, seeing. I believe that's possible. I think they might be like mandalas.
Very much like. I did not at the age of 11 know mandala. But certainly I have seen some mandalas since that did resemble some of the Sufi art, some of even some Persian rugs, if you will, have come somewhat close. And I wondered if maybe some of those rugs were designed in an altered state of consciousness, you know?
Yeah, yeah. I'm kind of a symmetrical being, you know, my right half and left side are, you know, they do things. Like, I'll get a pimple on my right cheek, and a few days later, it'll appear in the left cheek, same size. You know?
Oh, I've heard of people like that, yeah.
Yeah, so, where are you? Am I a symmetrical being?
Where are you?
He's never heard of that in his life.
You could be.
Where are you calling from?
Boise, Idaho.
Boise, Idaho. Mm-hmm. All right, Brad.
Hey, Jasper.
This also occurs to me. That's the reason I call resonates with me. I'll get a little skin mark on one side, then I'll get it in the same place on the other.
Interesting.
Interesting. What physically could you're not a doctor, I'm not a doctor. But
no.
What could explain that?
Again, I think it is your innate desire to be in balance. And that's really the key. I guess that's maybe I didn't mean to sound pompous a minute ago when I said how seriously we should take it. But the key to all of this is, as my friend Sun Bear would say, the medicine priest, walk in balance. We have to be in balance before we approach any of these spiritual disciplines or spiritual tasks.
Fuck your barriers.
I think you may have within you, my friend, just an innate desire to be in balance, which expresses itself even physical rashes.
Boy, did you hit that one on the head.
Oh, there he is.
Hi, Art.
Where are you?
My name is Larry. I'm calling from Abilene, Kansas.
Hi, Larry.
I just wanted to say something about those the images, the concentric geometry.
No, yes. We're getting a lot on that. Okay, Larry, let's hear it.
Well, I've experienced something like that myself. By the way, I'm also a Seneca Indian. So
I see. Okay.
But I get images like that whenever I'm in a feverish state.
Uh-huh.
So the Titans are.
And it only happens.
Oh, okay, we did it. That was it.
Say when I'm sleeping and feverish.
Like a huge problem. Mm-hmm. Have small
I know exactly what you're talking about with those
imaging. And isn't that something? So few people have responded, and suddenly, look at the feedback we're getting tonight.
That's
people
right.
Who have had that experience.
I
really appreciate your calling.
Okay, let's get the fuck out of here.
All right, I interviewed Robert Monroe.
Back to the hotel with us.
Mr. Monroe speaks of multi levels of ascension.
Mm-hmm.
Is that your view of things? Are there multiple levels of ascension?
Checking chat. You can see me like I'm just like.
Oh boy, I think there almost have to be, Art. I've always avoided terminology like that. I try to keep everything as simple.
Back when I had my second monitor above my first monitor, every time you see me like checking chat like that. Chat. No chat. Chat. Game. Chat. Game.
But then you do have to try to translate it. And I think there have to be levels. Just as I believe in powers
right.
And principalities.
I wish this had nitro boost and we could ramp.
I'm reluctant in one. There's one part of me, again, that mean, cold, intellectual part that doesn't want to. And then there's the part of me that experiences and explores that says, you have to. I mean, you have to somehow try to put it. Maybe you're dealing with the infinite, but you do have to put it in finite terms if you're going to communicate.
All right, are we at, do you suppose, the lowest level? In other words, in our physical bodies, are we at the lowest level? Is everything up beyond us, or are there lower levels, or what do you imagine? I know I'm asking for a lot of speculation.
Sure, I think there are lower levels. I think it is a really nifty thing to be a human being, but I think so few of us recognize our potential. And what I try to do in my...
Cross this bridge.
If I don't sound presumptuous, and I hope I don't, is to get people to explore their potentials. I don't care. I've been to lectures where someone stands up, I disagree with you. I said, but did I make you think? The person said, yes, you did. And that's what I'm trying to do, is get people to explore their potentials, to realize that they can be so much more
than they ever believed they could be. So I don't think we're at the lowest level. I think we're at a lower
so close.
Level than the higher beings around us. But I think we really are a transitional species. I really think we are the link between ape and angel.
Hold it right there. That's a and from St. Paul, Minnesota, Lynn would like to know.
I was close.
A big fan of yours, by the way. Whether you have read a book called Nothing in This Book Is True, But It's Exactly How Things Are by Bob Frisell.
I don't think I've read that one, no.
Because he discusses, you might want to. He discusses.
That's right. I hit the checkpoint. I forgot.
Sort of geometric patterns that you've been talking about.
Okay.
So here it is. It's just a flood of information. You say it, Gordon Michael Scallion says it, and and all of a sudden we're flooded.
Yeah.
Let's try a quick call, see if we have time. West of the Rockies, you're on the air with Brad Steiger. Good evening.
Hi, Art. Hi, Brad.
Hi.
I'm calling from California.
Okay.
And I met Brad in 1983 at a Dick Sussman conference in Arizona, and he told me that I was telling him but some of the things that had happened to me, and he told me to write about it. And I am a writer, but I find that I always have a writing block when it comes to the abductions that I've had and other things.
Mm-hmm.
It's a good question, Brad. When you're trying to apply, obviously you're successful with that many books. How do you find words to describe the indescribable?
Well, that's the challenge. That's what writing is all about. It's translating the thought, that, you know, non-physical vibration in our brain to paper, and then that's only the half of it. It has to resonate with the same buzz in the people who read it.
Well, how casually the caller talks about her abductions.
I kind of do a Zen thing.
Yeah, I'm trying to write about my alien abductions.
I try to write at the same time every day, but I certainly, you know,
had a few here and there, you know.
Very relaxed state. I don't intimidate myself with that doggone white paper staring at me. And I just say, you know, I can do it. I've got something to share. I've got something worthwhile. People, I love them. And that they are, if I'm excited about a subject, I just know there's someone out there who's excited. I've only written, the only model and guide I've ever had all these books are, is I write a book that I would like to read. And that's been my guide from book one to book 134 now.
So a little meditation on her part. All right, Brad, sit tight. We'll be back to you right after the top of the hour. And we are going to have to
I forgot. I've run into this invisible wall before.
Please. My publisher notified me that the first edition of my new book is going to be very shortly gone. I want to thank everybody who has gone crazy buying it. It's out shipping this week. If you would like a copy of my new book called The Art of Talk, which covers dreamland topics, covers talk radio, covers my life.
I've ended up in this exact same spot.
We've got a photograph of a ghost in there. That's what I wanted to talk to you about. Photograph of a ghost. Boy, have I got a good one. It's in my book, and we'll talk about it when we come back. My book, if you'd like to order it, The Art of Talk, call now. 1-800-864-7991. That's 1-800.
I would buy an Art Bell book. Probably full of so much fun shit. Like, these kind of like alien cryptid whatever conspiracies aren't fun anymore in the, not even like the digital age, but the post-privacy age, where everyone just has like cameras everywhere and everything's super high resolution.
And I mentioned a photograph of a ghost in my book. I'm going to be asking, it is in my book. There are so many photographs in my book that it's hard to recall them all. But since we're talking about this area, I do have a very, very sharp photograph, the best I've ever seen of a ghost. Brad has
talk about how photographs are it's so sharp, this one's real, but like, now that we have real sharp cameras, it's like, that's not a thing anymore.
1-800-864-7991. Do I sound excited about it? I am, yes. Brad Steiger, hi Brad.
Hi.
Your latest book is called The Awful Thing in the Attic. God, what a great title.
Yeah.
It is a compilation, you say, of some of the
best of the best.
Yeah, some of the things we've been talking about tonight.
And you have...
Okay, I am extremely not going the right way.
Give out the number for your book.
Right.
But in the book that I am just now coming out with, I have a picture, Brad, a stonemason down in Arizona.
Let's see.
In about a 100-year-old home down in Arizona.
Mm-hmm.
And he took a photograph. He was proud of his work, so when he was done, he took a photograph of the stone.
I think I could have probably gone either way.
And I'm telling you, Brad, I've never seen anything like it in my life, and I've seen a lot of things pretending to be ghosts.
Right.
But this was clearly a kind of smoky, I would describe it as a smoky, semi-translucent being.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, no question about it. I mean, clear as it can be. I put it in my book, and I every time I look at this photograph...
Oh my god, this game's so hard to navigate. That's fine, we'll go around this way, yeah. We can get back there.
Well, I've got some of my favorites in the book, as you might suspect.
Sure.
And then I have the handwriting of a ghost. The famous Borley Rectory in England, called England's most haunted house for years.
Oh, like the Borley Haunted Mansion in Silent Hill 3.
Entity began writing... when one pastor...
See, we learned something tonight.
Episcopalian moved in, and his wife seemed to really somehow activate the sympathy, sort of a sympathetic rapport with the entity, and began to write to Marianne, the priest pastor's wife. So one of the investigators of that famous case, Borley Rectory, burned some years ago, but sent me specimens of that handwriting of a ghost. I've included that in the book as well.
Specimens.
All right. How do people get your latest?
Well, hopefully, as with all the others, it would be in their favorite bookstore.
Mm-hmm.
But if not, if I may give out an 800 number.
You may.
It is 800-77.
Oh, wait, wrong way.
3454.
Well, that's a good number.
1-800-77-3454.
I love that comment. That's a good number.
The awful thing in the attic.
Huh. You know, how come you decided to call that instead of the awful thing?
Oh, I don't want to.
Everybody knows
fucking...
that bad things are usually.
I'm not even that far.
Yes, but in a house, in architecture, what is the attic? What does that represent? The mind.
The mind.
So the basement is the earthy part where maybe demons exist, but the demons that exist in the mind might be even more fierce than those that exist in the basement.
Oh boy. You wouldn't go so far as to say that the better things are in the attic and the more evil, darker things are in the basement?
That would be one level, but if we look at it architecturally, the attic would represent the psyche or
look at it architecturally.
So part of the book is also symbolic of art, of saying, you know, we have to keep our attic clean.
All right. Back to a couple of calls. East of the Rockies, you're on the air with Brad Steiger. Hi.
Hi. Just a thought. You were talking about the geometric images earlier, and I was wondering if there might be any connection between them and crop circles.
Ah. All right. Where are you, sir?
Abilene, Kansas.
Abilene, Kansas. It's a good question, Brad.
It is a good question. These were so colorful and so intricate. Now, I have seen some very intricate crop circles, but who can say? Who can say? Maybe this is the primum mobilium. You know, maybe that's what I touched, and maybe that's what's showing up in the crop circles.
Have
so,
you seen images?
That's an interesting thought.
Have you seen images of crop circles that remind you of the shapes you saw?
No.
They didn't say why.
The only thing I've ever seen that reminds me, as I say, is these fractal geometric designs.
Did it.
Fractal geometry.
All right, here's one that was inevitable. Hi, Art, love the show. Calling my friends to let them know how to tune in now. Please ask your guest who he believes Jesus was.
Oh.
Jesus is whomever you wish him to be. Whoever you want him. This is a powerful...
The last whale of a flying whale in Bright City. Escort him to the train.
West of the Rockies, you're on the air
and improvise.
Yes, hi, Brad. Years ago,
I was lonely.
Production,
to a book written by Paul Twitchell called In My Soul.
I want to befriend a flying whale. All right, let's go make friends.
Paul Twitchell is an out-of-body traveler a la Robert Monroe. And I was wondering...
Actually, let me check something.
Left the physical plane, I believe, was around 1971.
There's another 15 minutes of this. Let me queue up one more.
Experiences with him. I have heard incredible things about this man who I even heard that was able to change the local weather according to his wishes and several other phenomenal stories.
Well, I guess you know from reading the introduction, I was present one of those times when he changed the weather.
That's what I recall.
Oh, I would like to hear about that myself.
Well, Paul Twitchell was the living Eckmaster of Eckankar. I was privileged to know him for a number of years. He was a fascinating fellow.
Oh, this looks like a good one.
He never pressured me at all to become an Eckist or to join his particular movement. I guess he recognized me as a young scholar of the unknown, and we became friends on that level. We would meet just as friends in different cities in the United States, just to spend time, to art.
But
I've always felt as though I'm walking through time, and I think Paul Twitchell is one of
them. Probably get there on accident eventually.
Well, the lady said something about you were
present. Or I could just follow the sign.
Well, I was present a number of times when, like a powerful shaman, I've seen shaman do it as well, but Paul Twitchell had that ability to seemingly reach up and arrange the thermostat the way he wanted to. To change from rain to sun or vice versa, depending upon. He was a remarkable man, and I really felt as though I was privileged to know him at a very important developmental time of my life. And I've included material about him in a couple new books that will be coming out, as a matter of fact.
Brad, I'm going to ask you about something real serious. Very serious.
I've been
watching over many years now, and because of the nature of the work I do, you know, I'm on top of the news every day.
Right.
I have never seen as many volcanic eruptions, as many earthquakes, as many hurricanes. I believe we're down to P in the
That's right.
In the, we have and in
the
all
first
of
time.
Record,
oh.
In all of record
keeping. Oh, big guy.
It's never been. What's going on?
I would totally freak out.
Well, I was privileged some years ago. Some scientists brought me two semi-trailers material which they had been studying with a staff of thousands. The weather. I put this together in a book called Roadmap of Time, which outlined everything that's happening now.
Very cute.
But I guess it's
all right. Let's see. What do we do?
Everybody. It was a big seller and
escort him to the derailed train station. Loves the sound of moving
trains.
Let's play with bright yellow light.
This was done. The Nazis tried to steal this information in World War II. These two scientists in Chicago had staff of thousands put all this together. And I put it.
Should I flash them?
They brought me. Their heirs brought me this material. I spent 2 years putting it together. Called the Roadmap of Time, which I thought was a tricky little title too. But France and England loved it. This is time cycle art. We're entering a period of volcanism.
Aww.
We're entering a period of volcanism, and
he just needs a friend.
Changes, and it's nothing that's happened because we're evil and nasty. It's just the roadmap of time. It's the calendar of time. It's just like. Winter comes for us here in the Midwest, not because of any particular thing we have done or haven't done. It's
this
season.
Way.
This is the season for volcanism and storms and hurricanes, even before we started mucking it up with global warming and so forth.
Brad, is there, as we understand it, and there are the Mayan calendar and people who feel there may be errors...
Keep in mind, this episode of Art Bell is from, I think, 94.
The end of time is not far ahead.
Transition. I'm the eternal cockeyed optimist, and I think we're on the very brink of those. I think we're going to see more and more people beginning to make quantum leaps. I think we are in the process of evolving from Homo sapiens to Homo spiritus, thinking man to spiritual man, and you know, regretfully, and every quantum evolutionary leap forward. We will pray that as many people will be open to this and prepare for this as possible.
We know that some people will resist. Some people perhaps will not be prepared for that transition. But we do have an opportunity. I don't think we're coming to the end of the world. I think we're coming to a dramatic transitional phase.
Well, certainly something. Economically, politically, socially, every area you look at right now, I have summed it up by calling it the quickening. It feels like a quickening. Things are
A good term, Art.
Yeah, they're moving faster and faster and faster, and it's headed towards something.
Yeah, no, that's a very good term. The number one thing, aspect, question, comment that I get in the hundreds of letters I get every week is expressing what you have just said, my friend, that time is accelerating, that people know they're supposed to be doing.
Oh, I've heard of this.
The number one thing I ask is, what is my purpose? What is my mission?
What they're talking about in the radio. Terrence McKenna talked about, I think it's novelty theory.
I do try to show people techniques and exercises.
I think it's the idea that, like,
hopefully achieve greater insight into their
civilization is accelerating.
So
it's not like
spiritualism.
It's not a constant.
Well,
it's moving faster and faster. So, like,
I think this is schoolhouse Earth, and I think we are here given opportunity.
Discovering more and more and figuring out the universe so quickly.
The opportunity to
that, like, I think the idea is that, like, there's supposed to be a singularity where we just, like, know and understand everything and have created all.
This is all part of this unrest. And as I said, these scientists have studied every aspect of human endeavor, including sociological eruptions, including political.
And, like, I kind of get it. Like, 200 years ago, the periodic table sucked. And now it's like the only new shit we're discovering is, like, bombarding molecules with, like, an electron, and it creates a new element for, like, a trillionth of a second.
I was privileged to put it together, and as I say, I got permission from France, from England, from Earl. Can we quote this? Can we quote that?
I think Terrence McKenna died in the late 90s, early 2000s. It's been a little bit.
That I want to ask you that I've been wondering about myself. I have had great success, Brad. You have had great success in your field. Are there quiet moments?
I don't know where North.
Wonder,
where are we trying to get him?
Why? And
real light northeast.
Why you're so successful,
we're going to Woodville.
Has been given to you, or whether you
we're going east.
Of it, or I think every person who achieves some level of success,
which is behind the car,
moments of pondering why
all the time.
Yeah.
Which is where we're aimed. So that's good. Where's the whale?
I died at age 11.
Oh, there he is.
I came back an oar. I mean, I felt that I had the responsibility to share this, to share this good news that we are more than physical things, that
we
are spiritual beings, that we have an opportunity to help others. I think the bottom line is sharing and being one with others.
Very hard to see him.
The oneness is the important thing to me. And again, I feel blessed, and I feel that people say, my goodness, why do you keep going? Why do you keep doing this? Why do you keep...
Oh, there he goes.
I can't tell enough. I can't share
enough.
Good
boy.
I'm just, unfortunately,
we're going to get him a train.
She had near-death experience as children. She is an ordained Protestant minister.
Listen, the other guys were kind of, the Wyvern was cool. Well, Gollum dudes were kind of ugly. But this guy I want to keep.
As a mission or a ministry.
Keep
but
going
I think
east,
agree,
which we more or less are.
We're so happy, you're so objective, you don't push, you just present. And that's what I try to do, because if I sit down beside someone who says, I have the only answer, I have the only way, I know I'm going to get off that bus. I mean, I'm not going to go on a bus trip with someone who has all the answers, the only way, the only purpose.
Those people worry me as well. Stand by, Brad. We'll be right back. A little bit of business, then we'll be right back. Back now a couple minutes for the bottom of the hour. You there, Brad?
I am here, Art.
All right. Let's see if we can get a couple calls in.
Okay.
East of the Rockies, you're on the air with Brad Steiger. Hi. Wait a minute. Let me do that. Okay, now you're on the air, I think.
Hello.
Hello, where are you?
I'm
you
from Illinois. Satellite.
All right.
Mm-hmm. Hello, Art.
Yes.
Mr. Steiger.
Yes.
You mentioned a Mr. Sun Bear.
Yes.
Who I believe established the Bear Tribe Medicine Society.
That is correct.
Who believes that a cycle of civilization is coming to a close.
Mm-hmm. and you are familiar with the Hopi prophecies of a day of purification.
Most certainly.
And the coming of the blue star Kachina.
Mm-hmm.
And there is a strong belief amongst the Hopi Indians and other Indian tribes that this Hale Bopp could be a fulfillment of their prophecy.
Oh, now you have, what tribe are you?
I am just researching.
All right.
Okay, because you picked up a tribal accent there. I was trying to figure out which one.
I thought so too, Brad. There is a big comet on the way called Hale Bopp. You
mm-hmm.
know about it?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Could it be this blue star?
Well, again, my wife is half Chippewa, as well as being Swedish and French. So, she has worked with shaman and medicine people of many tribes, as have I. And I love these people, and I feel at one with them. I feel these things are very much symbolical. I feel that we are in that time of great purification. Excuse me, purification is what I choose. Not the end of the world, but another time of purification in which, you know, and I always hate to be doomsday at all, but as I say, not everyone is going to make it through, but a time of purification.
All right.
My wife and I feel is coming, and maybe this comet will herald it.
All right, maybe it will herald it in. More of Brad Steiger and Dreamland in just a moment.
Or Hale Bopp was a thing. Nothing happens.
Let's say exaggerated.
Uh-huh. I presume that you try to be very careful about exactly that when you're relating accounts, for example,
what?
In the awful thing in the attic.
Exactly.
Very good.
Okay, Whale, where'd you go?
A long time here. First time caller line, you're on the air with
No problem with the call. My name is Jack, calling from Olympia, Washington.
Hello, Jack.
Hi, Jack.
To do this from the top of the hill.
Yes.
I'm wondering if your familiarity with an author by Brandt, B-R-A-N-D-T, Kyle from Berkeley, California, published The War in Heaven, 1989. Own press called SR Press. He, like yourself, has an attention towards, addresses the importance of attention in manifestation and how it empowers the manifestation.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that perhaps there might be, rather than a field of daisies, at the edge of the cliff beyond that, in empowering manifestations and the cultural symbols that we pay attention to. And
where'd he go?
Rather than the idea of perceiving conflict as empowering the dark side rather than acknowledging that there is a war in heaven and that this time of transformation might be a final contest.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
That this is,
damn it, I lost the way.
The Invisible College, that which would further our race and help us to transform and what he calls a group of spirits or manifestations called the elementals that have hung around too long and begun to pervert and feed, harvest human attention.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, you're absolutely right. You've read enough of my books to know that I have dealt with exactly that topic and that theme very often. And
there he is. Hey, we're going this way now.
There is a war in heaven, if you choose to put it in those terms, that there are powers and principalities, and that we, as human beings, may indeed be the prize. And the prize of war, so to speak, the spoils of war, if you really want to be denigrating, I guess, to some people's ego. And so I very much believe that. A British author, you said something about a staggering amount, Art. He has written a book called The Dark Gods, in which he refers to the Steiger effect.
What? Oh, shit.
Well, in one of my books, I say, you know, again, how we deal with negativity is to confront always being cautious and so forth, but how, you know, we must drive it back. So
over
I
here.
Definitely, I don't think
shit.
I'm familiar
I'll
with
the particular
book. Again, please forgive me because people send me books and things. I love it, but sometimes I can't always keep up, but certainly the caller is right. My wife and I have dealt with that particular theme in a number of our books.
Well, if it is a war and we are the prize, seems like we ought to be rooting for one side or the other, eh?
Well, and that's the ticklish part, because by their work you shall know them. But again, as my wife always says so well, how does the negative, the dark side, present itself? It will never present us as ugly monsters. It's always going to be the seductive,
beautiful things of the that they will throw at us to delude us and seduce us.
Well,
so it requires balance.
Okay.
It requires discipline and discernment.
Try this on for size. I'll let it haunt you the way it has haunted me.
All right, my
there
friend.
There is a friend of mine.
There he is. Hey.
The son of Bill Lear.
Big guy.
I'm sure
yeah.
you've heard
Whoa.
That.
Yes, I know, John.
On one of my programs years ago, he said something that I'll never forget. He said, Art, it is my feeling, or I've been told, let me get this straight,
mm-hmm.
that when you die or have a near-death experience... the light is a trick, and you should go to the darkness.
I could not accept that from my personal experience, Art, but I would translate what John said, because I know John. We are certainly...
Can we get off this without...
I would interpret that as continual vigilance. As I said, discipline, discernment, and we must be vigilant always.
Okay, as long as he stays there.
One of my books... I guess that I resonate with in terms of the title is One with the Light, which as we speak is being made into a pilot film for a, hopefully we'll sell it, there'll be a series which deals with the near-death experience, but also the entire aspect of what it tells us about ourselves, about what we really are and who we really are.
I feel like I should look
and,
this guy up after
how,
this, Bob
how
Seger.
This energy. So certainly I would not say go to the darkness. I would say
not the singer.
to discern and discriminate who the players are. As I've
oh, this one's almost over.
Some people
oh,
say,
Brad
oh,
Steger.
I want to go for a ride in a UFO, and if the UFO lands, I will get in it and go off to this. And I said, well, before you do, ask to see the driver's license. I mean, you want to know who
oh,
you're getting in for.
4 years ago.
East of the Rockies, you're on the air with Brad Steiger. Where are you calling from, please?
Widely criticized by academics
Utica,
and skeptics.
New York?
Utica, all right. Turn your radio off.
Okay.
There you go. Go ahead, man.
I wonder if Mr. Steiger...
There's like 30 seconds left of this.
...his opinion on meditation or transcendental meditation.
All right. I guess that's... We've been talking a lot about that. In other words, that is the path to the greater understanding, is it not?
Well, certainly meditation, transcendental meditation may refer to a particular kind. I am not conversant enough. My friend John White has written a whole entire book about transcendental meditation. But meditation itself, I think, is the discipline, Paramahansa Yogananda, self-realization fellowship that I resonate very much with. And certainly Yogananda, speaks.
That's it. It just cuts off. Okay. Let me grab this other one. Triangle UFO sighting. The reporting. I think I was gonna do the triangle UFO one. Some of them are like.
One moment, John Lear.
Like there's one labeled like the dark side of religion, and it's like, nah, we don't want to do the fun shit. We want to do cryptids and UFOs and
online and able to hear what I'm saying right now. And I guess I'm going to begin this show with my experience, so it's out of the way. And I'm going to relate this experience to you because it really, in some ways, accounts for why John is here on this particular morning. Because when I saw what I saw this last Sunday, I picked up the phone the moment I hit the house and called John Lear's house. Unfortunately, at that point,
oh,
I got a
where's the whale? Oh, hey!
And, related briefly my experience.
There's
and,
a good boy.
John called me the next day, and it was like a confession or something. I had to get hold of John. So here's what happened briefly this last Sunday, and I will neither, if I'm able, add to it or detract from it. I'm going to tell you the story just as it happened. On my way home to a little town to the west of Las Vegas, about 60 miles to the west, called Pahrump, Nevada. And I was about a mile
oh, he's fast.
From home. And on a street that runs from east or east-west, and I was traveling east to west to intersect with a street that runs north-south and would take me on the final leg home. It was... about 11, it was between 11 and 11:30. I'm sorry, I didn't really note the time that carefully. But somewhere in that window between 11 and 11:30, I should suspect about 11:15 or 20 would be my best guess. And I was on this final street, and all of a sudden, you'll recall the moon was a bit fuller than it is now, so it was fairly well lit up. The weather conditions were calm. If there was a breeze, it was a very, very light breeze, as to be insignificant. My wife caught
something, right here.
I guess, out of the corner of her eye and turned around, looked out the back window and said, "What in the hell is that?" I said, "I don't know."
We might not have
and
seen
I
it.
And I stopped the car and turned off the headlights and rolled down my window. And coming up from behind us, just off the driver's side, was something large. I would guesstimate it would be 100 feet across. Absolutely triangular.
Triangular.
And I would guess it to be at about 150 feet in altitude. And it was coming up literally behind us. Its direction of travel was roughly east, southeast, and traveling towards the west-northwest.
There you go. Hi.
And it was lit. There were two white lights and one strobing red light. Strobing at a rate faster than you would associate with normal aviation traffic. The object was moving very slowly.
It seems he likes
the word
the
I would use to describe
spotlight.
Its movement
they
was more floating. Certainly
this.
It was going at a rate that would not sustain conventional aircraft.
Okay,
in
got onto the train.
There wouldn't be enough lift at that speed. So it was floating, and it literally
set the checkpoint
floated,
before I get stuck.
right across the, or very nearly across the top of my car, just a little off to the driver's side. And I'll tell you, the sky was lit well enough that when I looked up at it, I was able to discern the substance of it. And it was black and solid and triangular. And it moved out and across my area very slowly, floated out across, and continued to float in a west-northwesterly direction until I could see it literally going across the entire valley. And I was able to keep sight of it for, I don't know, maybe as much as three or four minutes somewhere in there.
Can't find the checkpoint.
And I finally lost sight of it. So I have absolutely no
idea. Oh, that was right next to the train.
Except that it was large. It was precisely as I described
it. So on this road?
It wasn't a guess. It was not an indistinct light. This was without question a craft. The question is, was it a craft that our military has, that we don't know that they have? Or was it from someplace else? I don't know.
Here we go.
I would suspect the first before the second, but certainly either one is possible. So that was my experience. I'm 48 years old. I've never seen one of these things before. I didn't think I ever would see one.
Big old whale guy.
My wife was witness as well. I actually put her on the air the other morning for about 30 seconds. Just because I didn't want to be out there twisting
we're gonna
the breeze by myself.
Take it out. We're going to drive the train out of town.
And I'm
going to bring the
about all
guy
this.
With it.
So there
the
it
train
is.
Is actually moving. It has been staying here for years.
For what it is,
it.
For what it's
that's
worth,
something to be
that's my
of.
Story. And I swear to you, it is true. John Lear. John Lear is an airline captain.
Oh, quick, I gotta catch up.
I've flown 160 different types of aircraft in over 50 different countries in all types of flying. Experimental test flying, production test flying, airline passenger flying, cargo hauling, movie work, stunt flying, aircraft ferrying, airdropping missions, racing, and secret missions of all kinds. Lear held 18 world speed records in the Learjet, including speed around the world, and holds the most FAA airman certificates issued to a single individual, which include the airline transport rating, flight instructor, ground instructor, navigator, flight engineer, flight dispatcher, airframe, and power plant mechanic,
we'll fix your train.
Tower operator, and parachute rigger.
Oh.
He's been a commercial pilot for
30 years. It's a little
years,
fucked up.
and has been flying for 35. He holds the Professional Air Traffic Controllers Award for Outstanding Airmanship.
Yeah, the whale whale's like, fuck it.
68. He's flown missions worldwide for various government agencies, flew in Southeast Asia between 1967 and 73, and has flown extensively in Europe, the Middle East, Afghanistan, the Far East, and Africa. As a non-sked pilot, he has over 16,000 hours of flight time, of which over 12.
It goes so hard on these credentials because they're like,
Lear's father, of course, was William.
They really want to back up, like, taking these people seriously.
The first car radio, the 8-track stereo, the automatic pilot for fighter aircraft, but who developed the Lear jet, one of the first and most successful of all business jet aircraft. Lear studied industrial design at the Art Center College in Los Angeles and was a state Senate candidate in Nevada in 1980. He's written extensively about airplanes and other subjects and was Middle East correspondent for Combat Illustrated between 1975 and 1977 while stationed in Beirut. He is an amateur photographer and astronomer and has won several photography awards for pictures taken during his worldwide travels. In the early 70s, Lear owned and skippered the 12-meter America's Cup boat Soliloquy out of Marina Del Rey. Lear's interest in UFOs began after reading Bud Hopkins' book, Missing Time, and then a chance encounter with U.S. Air Force pilot who was at a base in
England. Wait, is this exactly what they said before?
Landed in December of 19.
Wait, did I already play this episode?
Ladies and gentlemen, John Lear. Good morning, John.
Howard, how you doing?
Good to have you back.
Thank you.
I don't know where to start.
I don't think it matters because I'm
sure
just
you were listening and heard what I had to
I'm
say.
I'm winding down on this
exactly
anyways. I'm gonna keep it light tonight because it's a work
John,
night and I'm already tired.
And it's still I've been very thoughtful about it ever since. The audience has helped because they've kept talking about
it. I don't
it,
know, it's just been like not overexerting lately. Yesterday
I
was
any
busy
idea
anyways with all the Silent Hill stuff.
What I saw?
Well, if I had to guess, based on all the stories I've heard, I would say that it's an A-12 Avenger.
Okay, one other fact, John, that I did leave out, and that was that it was very still. I've said on the air you could hear a cricket a quarter mile away, and that was the case. It was very quiet. And as
finally,
close as this doggone thing was to me, John, it did not make a sound.
Okay, this is a
not
cool
sound
game.
I mean,
and I want to do more.
What kind of A-12 Avenger, what is that?
You have some very, very quiet airplanes, and like I said,
we have to fight the Kraken.
I think it was. The A-12 Avenger is the airplane that was canceled. It was the Navy.
Okay, we'll fight the Kraken next time.
It was canceled about a year ago.
A Kraken. How do you save?
It was being built by General Dynamics.
Hopefully it just auto saves or something.
And what happened is when
why is it lightninging inside?
Was drawn for this thing, unbeknownst to the public and everybody else, there was about 10 to
okay
15 of this craft already in various stages of construction. Most of them already built.
Yeah, I'm gonna go make food, maybe watch a dumb movie and
this, craft. They
it's comfy
asked
time
to get it in the air. Yeah, and they took these
comfy time
10 to 13 airplanes and worked on them. What they had
let's
to do
here
is, these were Navy airplanes ostensibly for a carrier, and they had to one of the overweight mechanisms was the wing folding mechanism and some other things.
You know what,
that
zombie's
and,
doing downpour I will
flying
post in his direction
extremely extremely quiet.
Hold on.
And they're the ones that are flying around now. One of the reasons why I say this is because if it had a
VH, what is that?
Like something extraterrestrial, it's possible that it would have canceled your or put out your headlights or your engine or something like that, which is usually the way. Also, there wouldn't have been the white light on it, possibly the red light.
Yeah, be quick, I'm wrapping up.
Seen, a saucer with a flight.
I started the raid.
Okay, one other aspect of it, John, was
make pizza.
It was flying too slow to be sustained in flight.
But yeah,
aerodynamically,
thanks, everyone who stuck around for this,
I'm
glad. Thank
I
you
mean,
for coming and hanging out.
John. Now that's
I'll see you more soon.
Because,
Good night.
Conventional craft, you need lift. And although the Delta Planform does create quite a bit of lift, it does need a little bit of speed. So I, you know.